You are about to experience the Drunken Peasants podcast, the greatest podcast in human history. Please recognize that this podcast is designed to be amusing and entertaining, and thus we engage in satirical comments, exaggerations, and even dirty jokes. If you are offended by such things, please go away and die. If you enjoy this podcast, we ask that you help to support its existence by contributing to our Patreon at patreon.com/DP. Contributors get regular access to monthly private shows, special commentaries, Google Hangouts with the peasants, and more. If you don't want to do that, you can also support the show by visiting audibletrial.com/drunkenpeasants to get a free audiobook and access to over 150,000 audiobook titles, including great selections on science and skepticism. And if you shop on Amazon.com, we strongly urge you to use one of the Amazon affiliate links in the description section of our videos. You can help support the show simply by using our link to buy things you were going to buy anyway. Now that we've got all that shit out of the way, sit back and enjoy the show.
Live from the frigid armpit of America, this is the Drunken Peasants Podcast with Ben and TJ, bringing you opinions of the news from an altered perspective.
Suck it!
There are starving children in the world, right?
Show me a child! Show me some empirical evidence it's happened! Yes.
What the fuck is wrong with you?
Lick my butthole, you laugh!
What the fuck is going on?
Nothing, TJ. You're garbage. You're garbage, TJ.
Now, here are your hosts, Ben and TJ.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Drunken Peasants Podcast, number 159.
Woo! Special. Yes. 159th episode.
Yeah, extra special. 159. A nice round number.
Extra crispy.
Oh, yeah. We've been waiting for this one.
Yep. This is a milestone.
159. That is the ultimate milestone.
159. I never thought we'd make it.
Our show has peaked.
Yep. You know, when
peaked, guys.
Ben and I started this
peak
show.
Peak oil.
When Ben and I started this show, it was like, you know, I wonder if we'll ever make it to 159 episodes.
Yep.
And I said, probably not, Ben.
I'm wondering when we'll make it to 98,223 subscribers, too.
Yeah.
When we hit that number.
No. Not going to happen.
No?
Wow.
Never going to happen. We're just going to start seeing unsubs. So this is the last episode of the show, guys. TJ always said, we hit 159, that's it. I'm done.
I'm done.
He said that many times. We've been
you get one
around.
More episode with me, though, because I've only missed one episode.
Oh, okay.
I've been in every episode but one. You still have quite a few left, Scotty, until you're 159th episode.
Yeah, I probably have like 20 more to go or something.
We'll bring Godsod on the show shortly here.
Momentarily.
Yes.
But first,
what DP show would be without?
Time to make the money.
Fuck off.
Fuck you, Scotty.
Shut the fuck up.
Scotty's a piece of shit.
Garbage.
I love that so much.
Garbage.
So we got shirts.
Shirts.
Motherfucking shirts. These shirts will actually literally rise up from the drawers.
The finest shirts known to man.
In the ass.
I guess people just aren't ready for the hoodie.
They're just not ready. It's not cold enough
yet. It's too much hoodie for them. They just
too much hoodie for you to handle.
They can't handle it.
They look at that shirt, they're just like, no.
I think they see the price tag and they're just, well, no, because the band TJ hoodie sells. It doesn't make any sense. How is the band
they
TJ
want
hoodie sell?
A band TJ hoodie.
But the Smoke Pan Everyday hoodie. When
we've
shirt,
sold it before, too.
And the shirt sells so well, so it doesn't make any sense. Why is no one buying the Smoke Pan
they
Everyday
hoodie?
They
want the giant banana on the back.
They're just afraid of getting shot by the police, I guess.
Yeah, they're afraid of the pan leaf.
Afraid of the fuzz.
Pan leaf.
Fans are a bunch of fucking cowards, man. But yeah, we got a shit ton of shirts available. You can see them all.
There's a link in the description to get them, and we will bring be bringing more diverse shirts to you in the future here.
Yes.
Enough white shirts. We need different shirts.
Yes.
We're going to have shirts for black people and you know, Latino
people.
We're
all about shirt diversity.
Yes. Yeah, it's going to be like, you know, any race can wear our shirts other than Eskimos.
Really?
You know, we have prejudice against Eskimos.
Yes. We do not. We do not accept them.
Patreon. Patreon's going good. Today's the last day.
Today's the last day. If you want to get in on any of these perks, today is literally the last day you can do it.
We have two slots left for our Cards Against Humanity hangout that we'll be doing. We're going to record a Google Hangout where we play Cards Against Humanity through a private link. And these 10 patrons will be able to participate in that, and then we'll post it as a video on the channel.
There's two slots left.
Two slots. One other thing here that we wanted to promote is our Drunken Peasants Fantasy Football League at fanduel.com/DP. There's a link in the description below. There was $750 in prize winnings given out last week.
None to me, unfortunately.
And there's another $750 up for grabs once again. This coming Sunday, there's 3 hours and... 3 days and 16 hours left. And right now we have just under 100 slots. We have 99 slots.
99
available.
Slots.
Yes. You said slots.
I'm going to redeem myself this week, I think. Redeem.
Yeah, Scotty's picks last week.
Actually, you know what? I finished just behind you, TJ. I was only like a few points behind you at the end of the day, though.
All right. So. No one cares about any of that shit.
All right.
It's time to bring on Godsod, PhD, a popular blogger for Psychology Today. He's a professor of marketing at John Molson School of Business at Concordia University. He holds the Concordia University Research Chair in Evolutionary Behavioral Sciences and Darwinian Consumption, and is the author of The Evolutionary Basis of Consumption, plus numerous scientific papers. He has a YouTube channel, he has a Patreon, he has a Twitter, and he has a Facebook, all of which can be found down below in the description section of this video. And he's coming on.
Yeah, we're calling him now.
He's being called.
He's in the process of being called.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
Hello.
Welcome to the show.
Hey, great to be with you.
Thanks. I guess we'll just get right into throwing a question your way. You uploaded a video just today called Racial Favoritism Occurs Across Racial Lines that offers a sharp refutation of the notion held by the SJWs that only white people can be racist.
Right, right.
And, that's
you're racist for saying that.
That's
TJ.
I mean, you're not going to find any disagreement in this room on that video. We think it's ridiculous too that this new definition of racism has sprung up. Why don't you give us a little bit of your insight into that?
From that particular study, from the clip,
or just on the issue in general?
Well, it really frustrates me whenever I hear people saying that the notion of racism is somehow tied only to whites. Since in the context of, say, the United States, whites have historically been, quote, privileged, and therefore the notion of racism could only apply to the dominant group, but it can't apply to minority groups. And of course, that's laughable because racism is not something that is monopolized by one group of people. It is a, if you like, ugly manifestation of our innate coalitional psychology, right? The idea of viewing the world as us versus them is not something that is endemic to people who have, you know, white skin pigmentation. You see it as often with Asians, with Arabs, with blacks, with whites. And so in that particular study that I was describing, this wasn't my own study, I was describing another researcher's study, they showed that the manner in which blacks and whites respond using brain responses, right? So you weren't just asking them on a 1-7 scale, tell me how you feel about this. So these were things that they couldn't be lying on. Well, when you show them people being administered a painful procedure, their empathic response if you like, mapped onto whether the hand of the person who was shown incurring the pain was of the same race or not. And this applied both to blacks and whites. And so what I was arguing there is that there is neuronal evidence that shows in this case that everybody is susceptible to this ugly part of human nature.
Right. I feel like, though, the problem is that no amount of evidence is going to usurp the semantics games that the SJW crowd likes to play, because they've totally redefined the term racism.
Right.
Basically through sheer willpower. They've changed the definition of racism to prejudice plus power. So only institutional racism is racism, and only white people can be racist. And I mean, to me, the problem with this is that it ignores that there's many white people who are not powerful, and there's many black people who are powerful. There's many people of all races who are powerful, and there's many white people who are not powerful. So it really doesn't. It breaks down because it tries to put everyone in these groups and say, you know, you're no longer this an individual, you're this group identification, and you have power based on your skin color, so therefore you're part of a racist institution, but I'm not because I'm oppressed and sad.
Exactly. Well, look, it's a mix of identity politics, which is very nasty and ugly, and victimology poker, right? Who's got the best and strongest poker hand when it comes to a victimology narrative. And so anything that takes a group that historically has a victimology narrative and somehow challenges that, well, we need to find a way to counter that narrative. And the way in this case you counter the narrative is by simply saying, what are you talking about? People of darker skin inherently can't be racist in the current system. It's laughable. It's crazy. I mean, the Rwanda...
And it's racist.
And it's racist. Now, as you may have seen on other shows, I can always get away with these things because I always hit people with the fact that I'm from the Middle East, therefore I'm a brown man, I'm Jewish, I'm an Arab Jew, I'm overweight, you can't mess with me, I score very high on non-privileged scale, and so
if
they usually stay away from
me. Transgender, you know?
Transgender, and maybe if I admit right here that I'm profoundly attracted to you, maybe then I'm off the charts.
There you go. There you go. Then you've crossed the threshold. You're not even.
Cannot be insulted.
No one is even allowed.
If anyone insults this guest, you're the fucking police are going
to
be on your
you've
ass.
You've got to be Adolf Hitler to be against this guy.
Yes.
To me, though, there's nothing more racist you can do than hold an individual person accountable for their entire race or some group that you feel like they belong to and just say, well, I don't need to know anything about you as a person. I just know this one fact of who you are. Therefore, I can apply all of these stereotypes that I have in my head.
Gingers have no souls.
Well, we played a video on the show several weeks ago. There was a gay black man that said he's not gay because gay is a white thing that was created.
He's a same gender lovin'. That's what he
is. That what he said?
Yeah. Yeah.
Same gender lovin'. Okay.
Yes. Right. Yeah. Not gay. Same gender lovin'. Because gay, that's white shit. That's part of oppression.
Yes. Yes. I understand. Yes. 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 Gay is a white affliction.
Yes. Only white people. Right. You know, I don't understand this because, I mean, I don't see how people look at white people like we're a collective organism and we share one unified mind with the same interests and the same values and the same sensibilities. I don't understand people who look at any race like that.
Well, that mechanism is at the root of stereotypical thinking and racism, right? When you argue that there is a blanket statement characteristic that captures everybody within a group. I mean, isn't that how racism is built? Isn't that how stereotypical thinking happens? So it's quite ironic that the people who are profoundly sensitive about issues of race are then the first ones to engage in the cognitive processes associated with racism in playing the identity politic games. It's just baffling.
Yeah, we're with you. I would agree completely with what you're saying there. I want to kind of switch gears a little bit. We will get back to race because we have a few videos pertaining to it. But I want to know, because you're critical of feminism as well. I've made numerous videos against modern day variant of feminism.
Yes.
And it seems to me like the current feminists are really not concerned with what I would consider substantive issues for women. It seems like most of them are concerned primarily with media representation and language policing.
Don't forget, yes. Don't forget video games. That's the
I was going to say. So stuff like female genital mutilation takes a backseat to the really important issue of how female characters are captured in games. That's where we really have to fight the injustices to women. All the stuff that happens to women, you know, over there in those other countries. I mean, who really cares? We need Anita Sarkeesian to, and I hate the fact that I know her name. I wish I could unlearn it, but I can't.
We all do. We all do.
Yes.
So we need Anita Sarkeesian to really help us fight the true injustices against women. Whereas somebody like Ayaan Hirsi Ali, who is a true fighter of women's rights, a black Somali ex-Muslim, you know, is a racist, misogynist, bigot in the world of modern feminism. I'll give you another great example that kind of relates to the completely broken moral compass of many Western feminists, not all. Camille Piglia, for example, wouldn't be part of those. But the idea of whether the bikini or the burqa is a greater symbol of exploitation and misogyny. Well, according to the brilliance and luminary thinking of many Western feminists, the bikini is patriarchal oppression because it triggers the male gaze, which is a form of visual rape. On the other hand, the burqa, by averting fully, by definition, the male gaze, right? You can't see the woman. That's actually liberating. So when you have people that actually spew that stuff, and it's not part of a Saturday Night Live satire, we're in trouble.
I've had an incredible amount of difficulty trying to even have a dialogue with feminists. I've made several videos about feminism that have over a million views. I've made one that has, I think, over 2 or 3 million views at this point. And despite that, despite the fact that I've made some of the most popular anti-feminist videos on the internet, I feel like they're one of the only groups that I can criticize that they will not engage me at all. Like, if I make a video about Republicans, some Republican somewhere is going to want to have an argument right with me. If I make a video about Christians or Muslims or anybody, they're going to want to come and challenge what I'm saying. But it seems like feminists, they're totally content to just live totally within a bubble.
In their bubble,
right?
Have
you discovered that as well?
I mean, only in the sense that maybe the way I structure my arguments is such that they feel that maybe I'm not really the good guy to go after. I'm not sure if it's because they don't wish to to engage me, or whether maybe they're not even aware that I'm engaging in this criticism. I don't have quite as large a platform as yours, so I'm really not sure. But
it seems to me they're not interested in defending their own ideas.
Right. The place where I have seen the confrontations that you speak of is really among my academic circle, and this is not necessarily only related to feminism, but this is where I argue that there are, of course, innate sex differences as part of my scientific work. Right.
Sure.
This is where you have feminists and more generally social constructivists, people who think that everything is due to social construction, nothing is due to biology. This is where some of the greatest blowback I've faced from fellow academics who traditionally have argued that, what are you talking about? Biology is relevant for hyenas and for the salamander, but what makes us human is that we transcend our biology. And to argue that there's anything that is innate when it comes to sex differences other than our genitalia is grotesque. You must be a Nazi. So that's really where I've seen it most, not so much in my public outreach outside of my science.
Right. I mean, that's a criticism that often falls upon evolutionary psychology as a discipline as well. What do you I've heard you give some really interesting answers about political correctness and its recent resurgence, because it's been around before and it seems like it's been defeated before, but it's like a cyclic thing, keeps coming back.
Yes.
It seems like it's worse. The example people favor, I think, the most is that, you know, Jerry Seinfeld, probably one of the blandest and most inoffensive apolitical comedians possible,
right,
you know, was finding that he couldn't do shows on college campuses because they're too easily offended. I'm like, what the fuck do you have to get offended with Jerry Seinfeld?
The offended squad has to show up. Come on.
Well,
they have to show up.
Chris Rock said the same thing, didn't he? Isn't that right?
Yeah, but at least I can understand how they would take offense to something Chris Rock said.
Because
at least he's saying... Yeah, but Jerry fucking Seinfeld?
I don't think I've ever heard Jerry Seinfeld swear or anything like
Maybe.
That.
Maybe. I think I've heard him swear, yeah.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I think, you know, a lot of humor takes stereotypes, whether it be differences between the sexes, whites do this, blacks do that, gays do this, heterosexuals do that, and it then exaggerates them, for comedic response. And so to the extent that you have the social justice warriors very, very concerned about these types of identity politics issues, then by definition, much of humor is going to be offensive to the extent that it is highlighting these differences, right?
Yeah,
so I think that's really the problem.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think there's any... and maybe there is some small segment of humor that's not based around this, but I mean, people have observed that humor is all about pain. It's all about someone suffering somewhere, someone's pride being challenged. You know, you can't have safe sanitary humor because that's not funny. The reason is funny is because it's pushing buttons and exploring ideas in a much more unlimited sort of capacity. But, you know, it's not meant to be taken dead seriously. That's why it's humor. But these people do take it seriously. Why do they take humor so seriously?
Well, I think it's exactly for the reasons that we're saying, that they simply can't accept that people could be made to feel a bit uncomfortable at some of these stereotypes, which in part are, you know, couched in truths, right? So if we're talking about sex differences and Chris Rock, as a matter of fact, I often have argued, and I think one of my colleagues even wrote an article about this, that, you know, comedians are quite intelligent in that they have to really be able to investigate slice of life and then make observations about it. And so in a sense, they're great evolutionary psychologists because they're able to pick up on these sex differences and then, of course, expose them in a funny light. Well, if you come from the perspective that there are no such thing as sex differences other than due to social construction and patriarchy, you're not going to want to have somebody up there highlighting those differences. It's going to, quote, offend me, right? There is a quote, universal right for people to always be in safe spaces, to not be offended, and therefore I need to be protected from your comedy.
Speaking of safe spaces, I know that this whole trigger warnings thing has really taken off in the universities and stuff, and you work within the university system, so
yes.
I was wondering has that creeped its ugly head around you at all?
So it has started. Usually, you may have heard this expression that when the United States sneezes, Canada catches a cold, right? I'm in Canada, for those of you who don't know. And so usually, whichever lunatic movement starts in the United States, I can expect that within a few years, we'll see it in Canada. So just, I'll come back to trigger warnings in a second. For example, the psychology of entitlement of students, I had taught both in the United States and in Canada. Historically, I had always noticed that the American students were much more entitled, perhaps because they paid much greater tuition fees and so on. And I'd always felt very thankful that in Canada, we didn't have that bent among the students. Well, the United States has sneezed, and now we have much more, you know, entitled students in Canada. And so trigger warnings are beginning to make their way. They're still not sort of very common here as they are in some of the prestigious universities in the United States, but they're making their way. I mean, so much so that I actually had the instinct to put an addendum in my course outline. I think last year was the first time that I did this, where I put a trigger warning, basically saying that life is a trigger warning, and that if you feel that you can't come into my class and hear about pornography and mate choice and pathological gambling and all of the things that make life interesting, then you shouldn't be in my course, let alone in university. So even in the context of my classes, I've had to try to nip it in the bud. Yeah, so it's a problem.
Oh, God.
Yes, sir.
I am so triggered.
We're triggered.
Right,
we're all triggered here.
I am deeply triggered just from you mentioning those things.
How insensitive.
Right.
Talking about life.
I don't know if you saw my, I wrote a Huffington Post article a few months ago where I actually listed, I had gone to some site, I can't remember the name of the site, some trigger warning site, some social justice warrior site, that had sort of offered some recommended concepts that should that would necessitate a trigger warning. And I don't remember the list here, but you could go check it out on my Huffington Post blog. I mean, you could probably fit every single human phenomena under this exhaustive list of trigger warnings. I mean, I mean that literally. Sexuality, and I'm not talking about, you know, I'm not talking about rape. Consensual sexuality, so mating, right? So I'm an evolutionary psychologist. If I wish to discuss mating, if I want to discuss sex differences, pregnancy, drug use, medicine, you know, evolutionary medicine, criminality, war, anything could be fitted under the rubric of a trigger warning. I mean, how is that possible? I mean, how could you be coddling these students' minds in such a way? I mean, what an offense it is to think that they are so fragile, they're such delicate, gentle flowers, that to hear about war might send them into convulsions. I mean, I escaped Lebanon under imminent threat, right? So how do you think somebody like me, who's got my personal history of being truly triggered, my trigger was I was going to lose my head, right? So how do you think I would feel when I see people sucking their thumb because they might hear rap lyrics that are a bit too triggering?
Yeah, I mean, it is pretty ridiculous. I mean, look, you know, everyone has things they don't like. I think that, you know, trigger warnings used to be like a psychological term, you know, for people who had PTSD or something like that. Now it's just, you know, anything that makes me the slightest bit uncomfortable, I need a warning before I'm subjected to it.
My latte was too cold. I'm triggered.
That's right. That's right. I mean, if a student has been raised by a single parent and hence has had maybe a tough upbringing, and if in your class you're discussing family dynamics, well, you better not mention single parenting because that might trigger that student in question. I mean, it's outlandish. I mean, I'll give you another great example, by the way. I've mentioned this on one or two other shows, so I hope some of your readers won't mind if I repeat it here. Not readers, but viewers. So I was at Wellesley College 2 years ago, giving a talk on actually the thought police, how the thought police regulates the free exchange of ideas. And so it was a very hard-hitting lecture in SJW Central. I mean, this is Wellesley College. So for your viewers who don't know, this is, I think, one of the last non-co-ed colleges, only women's college. So in the Northeast, outside Boston, very privileged students. They pay some outlandish tuition fee. And so after I gave my lecture, a student challenged me on the following. She thought that it was perfectly natural that at the start of a course, a professor, it's the start of the semester, I come in, there are 80 students in my class. I shouldn't assume that, say, TJ, I could look at him, you know, maybe he's got a beard, he looks like a man. So if I assume that he's a man and then I might address him, hello, young man, hello, sir, that would be a form of, you know, aggression, because what if TJ self-identifies as a woman? And so she thought that it was perfectly reasonable for professors to poll all their students about their preferred gender identities. And then, you know, I would keep sort of an Excel sheet. Okay, TJ looks like male, identifies as male. And so I thought, do you genuinely believe that this is a reasonable way for social dynamics to manifest themselves? I mean, does this sound reasonable? She goes, absolutely, because then in the case where somebody has a gender identity disorder, you wouldn't be offending them. So when you have somebody at Wellesley College, an elite university, actually believing in that narrative, it's not good.
Yeah, actually, just a few days ago, I made a video called A Gender Language Police of Tumblr, based on a group of people who wanted Everyone should be identified with gender-neutral pronouns until you knew what their preferred pronouns were.
Remember the comic they had was two people, like, there was all the pronouns, and it was like, they, say they. And if you, when in doubt, you need to say they.
I mean, you know, do these people...
You can't make assumptions.
Do these people who are trying to control language to this extent understand the minefield that they're trying to get everyone to navigate? Because anyone who takes this shit seriously is just going to be ripping their hair out trying to remember, you know, right. I can't say anything that could conceivably offend anyone in any way at any time. Basically, I might as well just not talk.
Don't even speak. Don't bother.
And or you might even offend people with your nonverbal cues. What if your nonverbal cues become politically incorrect? Maybe a smile is too much of a smile, and I should not show as many teeth because that is a sign of aggression, because showing your teeth amongst many primates or many animals would be a sign of a challenge, right? I mean, I'm being facetious, but you're exactly right.
I smile at a girl and she thinks I'm trying to rape her, you know?
That is rape.
That was a rapey smile.
That's right.
Or even leering at her. As a matter of fact, now I don't know the details, but from what I hear, some of the stats that you hear sort of thrown around in terms of one out of every five women is assaulted and so on. The definitions of assault are so outlandish that, you know, I think that just in the 10 minutes that we've been speaking, both of you have probably raped me 20 or 30 times. I think I've been now a victim of gang rape, right?
Because I'm sorry. Define,
yeah, I think you guys have been very visually violent against me, and I think it has to stop.
Well, it's all recorded, so there's evidence against us.
Yeah, we're all going to jail.
There you go.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I believe that literally any sort of, like, if her boob gets grabbed by some drunk guy at a bar, no, that's sexual assault.
Remember we dealt with, like, retroactive consent, where the woman could consent at the time, but then later on, yes, like a year later, was like, you know what, I didn't consent, rape.
Yeah, well, I actually have read feminist articles defending retroactive consent withdrawal. And I've also read one that said that all PIV sex, that's penis and vagina sex, is rape,
yeah.
Inherently, because of the power dynamics of our society.
I was in a public place and Anita Sarkeesian walked in and I took a photo of her and I was accused of raping
her. Did you look at her too, Ben?
I mean, literally you were accused of raping her? Is this, are you being facetious or serious?
I was, some of the people on Twitter were saying that
it's a form of rape.
And he stalked her.
Yeah, that too.
Yeah, Ben was at this place, this gaming place. It was a place for board games. And Anita Sarkeesian walks in. He's already there. He basically takes a selfie with her in the background. He posts it to our Drunken Peasants Twitter. She retweets it, but she blocks out our name and all that. But people, of course, figure it out. And, you know, all of a sudden Ben's getting accused of being a stalker and a sexual predator and all this other stuff. He was there before she arrived. He left before she did. It makes no sense. And there was literally numerous videos on the internet the next day about he's a stalker, he's a predator, he's a bad person, he's a
people suggesting that
culture.
I had broken the law also.
Yeah, wow. It's a violation of the law. Just total nonsense.
I'll give you another example that's, you know, along those lines, but that speaks to sort of evolved duplicitous tactics, right? I mean, men and women, when they are navigating through the minefields of mating, will engage in all sorts of, well, duplicitous behavior, right? I mean, men lie about how much money they make or how much status they have. Women lie about their age and their weight. I mean, just look at online ads and you exactly see those types of things. In other words, the things that men and women lie about are exactly the things that are desired by the opposite sex, right? And you try to ameliorate how you'll be perceived in the eyes of the opposite sex by oftentimes lying about it. Sure. Well, some argued that suppose you actually convince a woman to have sex with you, and during the dynamic of convincing her, you manipulated her, whether it be overtly, right? Let's say you lied, or let's suppose you're a high status male who, by the sheer fact that you are high status, it's very intoxicating to the woman. Well, in a sense, she has lost her guard that she otherwise would have because you are a high status male. So either if you actually engage in duplicity, or if you don't engage in duplicity, but are simply somebody who is desired by the opposite sex, and hence she cannot combat your desirable traits, those could weaken her resolve to protect herself against your advances, and then therefore you would have raped her. So basically, heterosexual mating ceases to be possible, because the idea that if a man or a woman engages in any form of duplicity, it's rape, it's going to be tough to reproduce.
Well, come on, it's not rape when women do it. We all know that. It's only rape when men do it. Any way that heterosexual men can be charged with rape is good in their eyes.
Right.
You know?
And you know, I think, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
I was going to say that, you know, I mean, we're making light of these silly positions, but there's a real, if you like, background that's very serious. And that is that the people who are truly aggressed, the women who are truly raped, and of course, that's a profoundly serious issue, it cheapens what they go through, right? So when the word rape becomes something that you can, you know, associate to any possible phenomenon involving dynamics between the sexes, it does a disservice to the true victims of this heinous crime, right? So right. In a sense, the women who, well, the women or men who are social justice warriors engaging in all this silliness are really doing their supposed cause a huge disservice. It's grotesque.
Yeah, well, I've always thought that feminism, in its modern incarnation at least, is a profoundly misogynistic worldview, simply because it basically views women as idiots and perpetual victims and, right. You know, you have no will of your own, you have to be protected from the world, you need all kinds of special privileges and expanded rights in order to succeed in a man's world and all this stuff. And, it just seems ridiculous, and I point that out, and people act like I'm insane.
Right. Are you familiar with, I think I might have sent you some of those articles that I'd written a while ago. Are you familiar with the notion of benevolent sexism? Do you know what that is?
I'm probably not, why don't you explain it to me? I'll see if I've heard of the concept.
Okay. I hope you're not familiar with it, because you're going to enjoy this if this is the first time you hear this. So much of the sexism that you could think of, right, would fit under the rubric of hostile sexism. Okay, so whatever sexism you're sort of thinking of, let's put it under hostile sexism. But then there was these feminists uncovered a new form of sexism, and it's called benevolent sexism. And there's actually a scale that has been developed, a psychometric scale, to measure, let's say, TJ's or Ben's benevolent sexism score. And basically the items, and I've listed all the items from the published scale, and you can go view them. I mean, it's all there documented. So if you're chivalrous to a woman, if you open her door, if you think that she should be defended, if four guys are accosting her in a violent manner and you jump in to protect her, if you believe that your life isn't complete without the love of a woman, I mean, every imaginable nice thing that you can think of, being gallant, being chivalrous, falls under benevolent sexism. Because yes, I mean, sure, you don't hold these hostile sexist views against women, but that you think that they need to be taken care of and that you have to give them a gift and treat them with, you know, respect and open the door for them. Well, that also is a form of, condescension. You're patronizing them. So the reality is, if I answer on that questionnaire, I mean, and there's actually an exact question, I don't remember the exact wording, but do you believe that your life would be incomplete without the love of a woman? If I answer yes to that, I am benevolently sexist. It's going to make it hard for me to reproduce.
Well, I guess the proper attitude to take towards women is one of total neutrality.
Right.
I have no feelings about women one way or the other.
That's right. I'm not hostile. I'm not attracted to them. I'm indifferent. I respond to them in the same way that I would respond to a melon or to a pine tree.
That's the ideal way to be, because anything more or less than that is total sexism.
Yeah. And of course, as you probably also know from social constructivism, the only reason why I ever was attracted to women, and specifically, let's say, my beautiful wife, is that I learned it through Hollywood images and watching the Oprah show. Had I had the misfortune of growing up in a social construction environment where men were taught to prefer, say, lawnmowers, right now I could have produced children with my favorite lawnmower. You know, so it's all the vagaries of social construction that led me to marry my wife.
Yeah, and we've all seen that societies that do try to rigidly control sex, like the Catholic Church, are always very successful at doing so. It's like there's any biological imperative to have sex or anything. It's all just society programming us. You know, it's weird that every other mammal on Earth has sex, but
that's right.
You know, they must be watching some bad TV or something in the side.
That's right. There's like a macaque version of our socialization and a salamander version and a zebra version. Yes, absolutely. But you know, just to get serious in terms of the scientific literature. So in several of my books, I argue that if you want to study universal phenomena that are part of our biological heritage, you could look to fossils of the human mind. And what I call fossils of the human mind are cultural products. So, for example, if you want to know about are there such things as universal mating preferences that transcend time, that transcend cultures, well, you could study folk tales and literary products spanning several thousand years and widely different cultures, and you could do a content analysis of these products to show that, you know, the ideal things that men look for in women and vice versa are profoundly similar, irrespective of time or place. And so this, by the way, is exactly contrary to the social constructivist position. So I'm arguing that by studying the content of cultural products, it says something about the human mind, while they argue that the human mind is born empty, right? There are no biological imperatives, and it's the literature and the music lyrics and the movies that shape us into who we are. So it's the exact, perfectly opposite causal mechanism. It's idiotic. It's buffoonish.
I've even seen John McIntosh. I don't know if you're familiar with him. Oh. He's basically Anita Sarkeesian's puppet master. A lot of people speculate, anyway.
Okay.
I remember reading a tweet from him once where he was explaining that too often people who make entertainment get away with just saying, well, it's fantasy. But he says, right. You know, there's no difference between fantasy and reality. They should be treated as though they're the same.
Right.
I mean, I don't even know how to respond to something like that.
So he's saying what? That fantasy does not correspond to reality, or that they are interchangeable, or I didn't exactly follow his comment.
What he's basically saying is that anything that's depicted in fantasy might as well be really happening, because it's basically just an extension of reality, and it really doesn't make a lot of sense, honestly.
No. But I'll give you an example. So let me give you two examples of how you would use my idea of doing a content analysis of products to study mating preferences. So,
sure.
So men, let's begin with women. So if you look at romance novels, okay, romance novels are almost exclusively consumed or read by women around the world.
Right.
So there is no place where it is men who are the dominant consumers of this genre of quote literature. So if you wish to study, female mating preferences, a wonderful way to do it is to simply do a content analysis of the male protagonists typically depicted in romance novels. And what you find is that it's as if they basically cut and paste the exact same descriptor across every single romance novel that's ever been written anywhere in the world, right?
Yeah.
Right? The guy is never, you know, a pear-shaped, nasal-voiced, beta male who is an unemployed janitor, right? Who whines a lot, right? He is usually tall. He is royal. He's right. He's a count. He's a neurosurgeon. He is a risk taker, reckless with his love, but who could only be tamed by the love of this woman. He wrestles alligators on his six pack. And so that particular depiction is perfectly indicative of the things that women fantasize about. So to go back to this idea of fantasy versus reality, they're fantasizing about a very real idea that they hope to aspire to be with, right? So think, for example, about in the Seinfeld episode, earlier you were mentioning Seinfeld. So there's the classic Master of My Domain episode. Are you familiar with that episode?
Do you know what that is? I'm not sure.
So So in Seinfeld, I mean, you're familiar with Seinfeld, of course, the show.
Yes, sure. Yeah, okay. Right. I don't know if I'm familiar with that particular episode, but yes.
Got you. So in that show, the Master of My Domain is a euphemism for masturbation. And so in that episode, you basically have the three male characters and the female character making a bet as to who could go the longest number of days resisting their masturbatory urges. And so the first thing that they do is they place some money into the bet. And of course, they right away recognize that Elaine, the female character, has to put much more money into the pot, because they recognize that physiologically, right, an innate sex difference, it's much easier for women to resist that urge. So that's part one. But then part two, as each of the character loses, in other words, succumb to their masturbatory urges, I did a content analysis to kind of look at, so what did the script writers of the Seinfeld episode do, right? I mean, so in the case, for example, of Kramer, when he kind of goes over the euphemistic edge, it's because there's a woman across the street who is a young woman, scantily clad, exercising in all sorts of suggestive positions, right? So it is a visual stimulus that ultimately led him to masturbate. Now, let's go to Elaine. Is it a young Cabana, 18-year-old boy with the tight buns that got her to masturbate? No. She fantasized about being the long-term partner of John F. Kennedy Jr., the guy who passed away, the son of JFK, who is a tall, high-status guy who some people thought one day would be president of the United States. So her fantasy, the thing that got her over the edge, is perfectly indicative of the types of things that women fantasize about. So cultural products are incredibly rich data source to study these types of sex differences. Script writers may not know all the fancy biological reasons as to why a storyline works, but they are Darwinian beings. They just instinctively know what works or doesn't.
Right, because they have to write something that's genuine to human nature, or it's not going to resonate with an audience.
Exactly. And there's actually a company, and I never remember, at some point I should try to track it down. I think there was a company that, going back to the romance novels, and then we could talk about pornography on the men's side if you'd like. So there's a company that decided, you know, they wanted to do away with these sexist, masculine archetypes, right? They wanted to create a new vision of a man, vision of a man that's more sensitive, that's in touch with his feelings, that, you know, sucks his thumb and listens to Taylor Swift. And what do you think happened commercially to that company, guys?
Totally failed, totally floundered.
Exactly, right? So when people ask me, you know, how do you apply in a practical sense evolutionary psychology to marketing? Well, here's how you apply it. Good marketers are those who understand human nature. Those who think that the consumer's mind is infinitely malleable and I could teach the consumer to like whatever it is that I want him to like are going to fail. So a good marketer is ultimately a applied evolutionary psychologist. It's somebody who may not have the book smarts of what evolutionary psychology is, but they certainly understand human nature. Otherwise, they wouldn't be good marketers. Do you want me to go on to pornography, or do you want to step in?
You can go on to male pornography in a second. I just wanted to add something really briefly about the romance novels, because I used to have a female friend who was very into those. And just a little bit of a little tidbit from an addict to romance novels, which are really not even romance novels so much as they are just girl porn. Right. But they... she said that the more steamy the cover, the less sex there actually is in the book. But if there's not, if the less steamy the cover, the more actual sex there's going to be in the book. I don't know what the correlation is there, but she showed me what she meant, and it seemed like it was true.
Well, but I learned something new.
Go on with male pornography, right. The contrast.
Right. So I gave you the example of the, you know, female pornography in the sense, the sort of the romance novel, erotica stuff. So in the male context, if you want to study what's up with my hair, why is it looking? All right, here we go. We're it's looking fine. Good. Wait, hold on a second. Here we okay. go. All right.
Headphone hair.
That's right. Headphone hair.
That's why so, I wear a hat.
So if you look at pornography that is targeted to heterosexual men, so think for a second about, you know, so there are two types of, if you like, polygamous arrangement. People say polygamy incorrectly, so let me just kind of define this. Polygamy just means one to many, right? Polyandry is when one woman is with multiple men. polygyny is when one woman is with, I mean, one man is with multiple women. So throughout history, most cultures have accepted polygyny, meaning one man with multiple women. So, for example, harem building is usually some emperor who has a harem of women, right? So you think that when men would be fantasizing, they would typically be fantasizing about, you know, they are the central male protagonist and they're surrounded by five women, all of whom are, you know, desirous to have sex with that guy. So now if you do a content analysis of heterosexual pornography targeting men, what you find actually, and that study has been done, and you'll be interested to know that the guy who did the study is aptly named Nicholas Pound. right? No worries. No, I was waiting for the chuckle. So Pound did a content analysis where he showed that actually there is a much greater number of polyandrous depictions in heterosexual mating. In other words, there are many more instances of multiple men having sex with one woman than the other way around, which at first might seem surprising, right? Because we all sort of think of the fantasy being one guy wanting to have sex with many women. Before I get to the explanation for this, do you guys have any, do you want to take a crack as to why that happens?
I have my theory, but I'll throw it out there. I just think that they like seeing her get overwhelmed by as many dicks as possible.
All right.
That would be the appeal for me anyway. So
that language might have been the trigger warnings that I saw on Twitter. but I could handle it. It's okay. I grew up with rough guys playing competitive soccer, so don't worry about it. You could dish it all out. I like the overwhelming theory, the overwhelming phallic theory. Let's call it a more gentle way. But no, it turns out that it's actually an argument of sperm competition. So, for example, if you look at animal husbandry, you look at other animals. If you want your resident stud to literally rise to the occasion, right, to get excited to provide you with stud services, what farmers will often do. Or breeders will do, they will show him another male having sex with a female. That will literally get the rise out of him. And the idea being that it's because it cues, it's an excitatory cue of sperm competition. I really have to get into this because there's going to be a lot of sperm competition. Now, okay, the theory sounds very nice and it's been demonstrated with a lot of animals. Now, how do you actually go and test such a theory? Well, now I'm going to tell you a study that's absolutely mind-blowing. So two scientists, I think in 2005, took this idea and said, well, how should we test it? So they had men either masturbate, so to go, you know, go home or wherever it is. Here's an image of either a polyandrous depiction, right? Several guys having sex with a woman, I don't know, two or three, whatever it is, or a non-polyandrous, you know, erotic image, masturbate to both, and then guess what? What they analyzed. I think you could imagine what that might be. What do you think they analyzed?
Sperm. Yeah, the sperm competition.
Okay. So they analyzed the density and the motility, right?
Motility of the sperm.
And what they found, incredibly, so if the sperm competition hypothesis holds, then you should expect that the sperm that is reeked from the polyandrous images should have greater motility. And that's exactly what they found. Now, they don't know the mechanism, right? So they don't know how, you know, a man's body responds so that their sperm becomes, so to speak, more vigorous as a result of being triggered by, you know, visual cues of sperm competition. But that's exactly what they found. And this is a wonderful demonstration of how powerful evolutionary thinking is, right? I mean, you could have never even imagined conducting such a study if you weren't aware of these evolutionary principles. So that's the beauty of evolutionary psychology, is that it opens up lines of inquiry that would have been dormant and invisible to you forevermore.
Right. I remember telling one of my friends about evolutionary psychology after I started getting into Steven Pinker and stuff.
Yes.
And he was very, very averse to the idea, just on an emotional level. Like, he didn't like the notion of human behavior being explained like that. I'm sure you run into a lot of that stuff, too.
Oh, massively. So you know, one of the things that's both very exciting in my scientific work, but also exhausting, is that it really triggers, to use the term, a lot of people, both in terms of making people excited. I mean, those who are open to scientific explanations say, my God, I love this stuff. It makes so much sense. It's so intuitive. Yes, bring on the evolutionary explanations. But then there is, on the flip side, there is a whole range of detractors who despise evolutionary psychology for nothing related to actual scientific, you know, for any arguments of scientific merit, but it's because it attacks whatever is their pet ideology. So if you're religious, you think that evolutionary theory is a Zionist plot to introduce atheism into public discourse, okay? And, you know, where is God in all this if evolution is right? So if I'm a religious person, I might hate evolutionary theory and evolutionary psychology in particular. If I'm a feminist, well, it's obvious why I might hate anything that says that there are innate differences and so on. If I'm a postmodernist, I hate evolutionary theory because postmodernists think that there are no absolute truths, there are no human universals. So to the extent that evolutionary psychology
proposed, I think that was his objection. I think that was exactly the basis of it, yeah.
There you go. So he's a postmodernist buffoon. Got it.
Yes.
Now you've got the social constructivists who believe that, hey, what makes us human is that we transcend our biology, we're born with empty slates, and it's only culture that shapes us. We are a cultural animal, unless all, in comparison to all those other species, right? That's what makes us unique, is that we transcend our biology. And that actually is called the human reticence effect, the idea that, you know, it's perfectly feasible to use evolutionary theory to explain the behavior of every single species out there in fauna or flora. But when it comes to humans, somehow evolution bypassed us, right? Now, there's a slightly different version of this. I call it the evolution stops at the neck bias. So some academics and lay people are perfectly happy to accept that evolution explains humans, but as long as you don't use it to explain the human brain. So if you use it to explain why we have opposable thumbs, or why our pancreas have the function that they have, or why the heart is shaped the way that it is shaped, then it's perfectly fine. Use it to explain all of our organs, all of our morphology, but magically evolution absolutely stops when it comes to the most important organ that defines our personhood, which is our human mind. So for all of these different... Yeah, go ahead.
I'm sorry, do you think there's any extent to which we transcend biology, or do you think it's 100%?
No, absolutely not. And actually, that's a great question that you asked, because hopefully it allows me to tackle another misconception about evolutionary psychology. Many people who you know, the test evolutionary psychology think exactly in line with the question that you asked, which is, it is genetic determinism, it is biological determinism, it is reductionist. It basically removes the influence of the environment and of culture and socialization. None of that is true, right? Evolutionary psychologists perfectly recognize the importance of socialization, of culture, of, excuse me, our environment. They absolutely don't negate that. All that they are doing is first recognizing that, sure, that's true, but we also do have innate biological blueprints. And they do a second thing. So the second thing that they do is they're not sufficiently happy with simply ascribing culture as an explanation. So for example, if I tell you, why do people here do it this way? And you simply say, well, it's due to their culture. But that begs the question, well, but why is that due to their, I mean, how did their cultural tradition evolve to be of that form? And let me give you a great example of that. So for example, if you look at the use of spices, how much spices are used across culinary traditions, right? I mean, Mexicans have more spicy food than the Swedes. So if I were a cultural anthropologist or a cultural psychologist, I would simply be happy. I would revel at the fact that I've simply identified these cultural differences. And then I would step back and say, my, isn't the world rich? It has so many rich cultural traditions. Well, the evolutionary psychologist would say, okay, that's great. Sure, you've identified this cultural difference. But the next step is to say, do we have any framework that could help us predict why the patterns of spice use around the globe exist in their particular form? And the answer turns out to be very much rooted in biology. Can you guess at all what it might be? I'm not trying to test you. I'm just wondering if you have an intuition. Do you know what might be the reason why culture A has a lot of spices in their food and culture B doesn't?
Maybe the availability of the spices.
I mean,
That's great. That's a great answer, but actually that's controlled for. So we could control for that. Okay. So that's not it.
I was thinking maybe something along the lines of cultures distinguishing themselves from one another by adopting things. Like if you eat the spicy food, then it's like we're tougher. We eat this spicier stuff than these other people over here. You know,
good shot, but no. Good attempt though. So
thank you.
Spices are basically a wonderful means to solve a very important biological problem, namely exposure to food pathogens, right? Mm. This is called the antimicrobial hypothesis. So culinary traditions such as pickling, smoking, spice use, all of these different traditions are adaptive solutions to a very real biological problem, namely, you know, I could die if I'm exposed to nasty food pathogens. Now, it turns out that the density of food pathogens is correlated to the temperature of that particular culture, right? Hotter climates have greater density of food pathogens. Now, so guess what happens? If you put on the globe all these different spice, you know, use, it perfectly correlates with what I just said about food pathogens and so on. So therefore, I'm sorry, just let me just finish and then you could jump in. And so that's a perfect demonstration of how evolutionary psychology is used not only to identify human universals, things that are the same across culture, but it also is used to explain things that are different across culture. Go for it.
Speaking of things that are different across culture, I've seen you talk occasionally about cultural relativism.
Yes.
And about the problems you feel it creates. Maybe you could get into that real quickly.
Sure. Cultural relativism is basically the idea that, you know, it there is no such thing as a human universal. Every single culture has to be studied in its idiosyncratic context. So the idea that there is such a thing as a universal human nature to cultural relativists is laughable, because how could you say that, right? Papua New Guineans are very, very different than Bedouins in the Negev Desert in Israel. And to try to find the universal that is common across them is outlandish, according to cultural relativists. Now, that original movement, I'll first talk about it in the context of in science, and then in terms of some of the problems in geopolitics. So the original cultural relativists understood that many people misappropriate biology for their nefarious ends, right? So the Nazis say, hey, look, there's a battle between the races and we're the Aryan race, we won, let's kill the Jews and the gypsies and the homosexuals. Hey, that's Darwinian, what's wrong with that, right? And so for all sorts of miscreants who misused evolutionary theory, these academics came along and said, you know what, biological knowledge is dangerous. So let's create a new worldview that basically abdicates biology from an understanding of human affairs, and hopefully we can no longer have this problem of having nasty people misusing biology. Now, in the context of non-scientific pursuits, what you end up with is an offshoot of cultural relativism, which is moral relativism, right? I mean, who am I to judge the cutting off of clitorises of 6-year-old girls? I mean, hey, that's their culture, right? So, well, that's grotesque. Well, what do you mean? I mean, we should be able to have a universal moral compass that allows us to understand whether the cutting off of a young girl's clitoris is something that should either be condoned or condemned. But under the general cloak of moral relativism, you get a lot of faux liberals, or I love the recent term regressives, who are simply unwilling to ever criticize these cultural and religious practices from other people under the guise of, hey, it's their culture, therefore it's morally relativistic. No, it's not. You should be able to stand on a particular position.
I agree. I wanted to maybe take a look at some videos here. We have a video of Anita Sarkeesian and Zoe Quinn addressing the UN.
Now, where do I look on my thing? Do I just look on my? Oh, yeah, I see. I got you. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. We have a screen shared with you, so you'll be able to see everything that we see.
Oh, beautiful. Okay, go for it.
All right. Okay. Here it is.
Let's come down to a very individual level. Let's talk to
this is at the UN.
Anita and Zoe. Zoe, perhaps you first, in your personal and work environment, what have you witnessed as being most effective in addressing this kind of violence against women?
Violence against women.
Who works in tech and somebody who runs Crash Override Network, it's, I think, the only direct victims assistance and crisis center for people who are currently under online abuse, as well as a victims advocate group. We've handled, I think, over 1,000 cases since we launched in January, and we're staffed entirely by people who have been through this.
They've been through online abuse.
Yeah.
It's right.
Horrible.
As we know, you can't disconnect from the internet. It's impossible.
There's no way to prevent that or to stop it from happening.
Yes, yes.
You're just powerless against it.
How could they live to love another day? Wow. Go for it.
It's amazing how they keep going.
We deal a lot with triage, so people come to us when things have already gotten to the worst. And I can tell you right now that one of the most effective things we see is an active and humane response on tech partners' side. That is one of the most effective things, and it's also often sorely lacking. This requires proper moderation.
Are you familiar with Zoe Quinn at all, God?
I'm not, but having looked at her for about a minute, I already know unequivocally that I dislike her.
That's good. She basically she got into some hot water because it was revealed that she was a game developer, an independent game developer who made some terrible game, but she basically was accused of having sex with a number of journalists and game developers so that they would promote her game. Now, the veracity of that, I don't know. It was all kind of tabloidal, but it did push her into mainstream celebrity status for some reason, at least in terms of the SJW.
That was the beginning of Gamergate,
it kind of,
most people say.
Okay, got it.
Which takes into account things like intersectional feminism. So terms of service taking into effect things like the fact that trans women often face a very specific type of violence called dead naming, where people post pre-transition names in an effort to intimidate.
That's not violence.
What was that? Pre-transition names?
Yeah.
So meaning what? They
so like them? So like Bruce Jenner.
Yeah, if you call Bruce Jenner, if you say
you don't say Caitlyn, you say Bruce. That's right. A form of violence against Caitlyn.
It's violence.
Yes.
It's
violent.
Violent.
Yes, gonna be killed.
That is
well,
yeah.
So you basically have honor bride or child bride, honor killings, throwing of acid on women's faces. Being stoned to death for being the victim of rape, having your clitoris cut off. That's one type of violence that women face. Another type is to be called Bruce instead of Caitlin. It's all the same. It's all relative. It's all violence.
And it's all equally deplorable.
It's all equally deplorable. That's right.
And endanger their lives. Things like they need to be trained in things like the way domestic violence can manifest online, because the viral nature of the internet can take all of the goodness about things like marketing, things like grassroots activism, and apply it to domestic abuse just as easily as you saw in my case. Or maybe you didn't, but yeah. Well-trained responders, and that's not just in tech companies, but as well as law enforcement, that don't end up re-victimizing the person dealing with this, as is so common in domestic abuse and other sorts of abuse, which is also, again, not often found. And supportive social networks that don't downplay what's happening, that don't tell them to just get offline and hide, which we've seen in cases like Kathy Sierra's.
You don't even have to hide. It's online. You can just tell them to go fuck themselves. You can block them. There's a million and one fucking options available to you. You can do so many things. Sorry, God.
I should say that I'm very fortunate that given whatever platform that I have, I'm actually very lucky in that I don't have too many trolls. But the one percenters that kind of come after you and abuse you and put stuff up and so on, you're exactly right. I mean, you could try to engage them, and then once you've had enough, you block them and the problem is solved, right? So I don't walk around saying that I've been a victim of internet violence. I don't walk around saying I've been raped. I basically say that there are some real assholes out there who annoy me, and then I block them and I move on in life and I learned to love again.
They're not willing to do that. Why don't we see what Anita's segment is all about?
Oh, you want me to skip ahead?
Yeah, why don't we skip ahead to Anita and see what she's talking about? Blah 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 blah.
I'm a victim. I'm a victim. Right. Okay.
Let's see. Is this the point?
Yeah.
Let's take a look.
Humane. You would assume most peer-to-peer counseling would have this, right? But clearly that's not the case. Now, you say you've had 1,000 people since January. Yes? Tell me a little bit about your catchment area and this, you know, like who makes up these people that are coming to you.
I think they're still talking to Zoe.
Putting out guides if we find ourselves having the same conversation. Yeah. So
let me skip a little more forward here.
Sure, sure.
There we go. There she
not
is.
For 3 years.
There she is.
With your work through Feminist Frequency, how do you interpret a multi-level approach to working on these issues?
Yes.
What does that mean? There's just
a multi-level approach.
Multi-level approach? Shouldn't all approaches be multi-level? I don't.
That's
okay.
Off my pay grade. I don't speak POMO.
Yeah, this nebulous language.
So, Feminist Frequency is a nonprofit that I run where we look at the way women are represented in the media. And by doing this work, I have been the target for 3 years nonstop.
I've been the target of selfies.
Egregious online harassment in all levels. I think it's important to recognize that harassment is...
That's all that she's been subjected to is harassment. No one's ever tried to have a rational discussion with her. It's all been harassment. That's it.
Yeah, and
Go ahead.
About it being a nonprofit organization, I mean, that's true now, but she was actually claiming it was before it was.
Yeah.
And able to demonstrate that, so it's pretty sad. Yeah, she was claiming she was a nonprofit organization. People looked to see if it was filed as one. No one could find anything, and the heat came on her, and then, of course, then she finally actually registered as a nonprofit organization.
Now, but isn't the fact that people investigated her for that lie a form of judicial rape?
Yes, it is.
Yeah,
and also the worst form of misogyny ever.
Yes, yes.
Worse than clitoral mutilation. Way worse than actual rape.
Yes.
Way worse than any of that.
Now, imagine this woman. I mean, again, and I've actually made that comparison. I think comparing her to someone like Ayaan Hirsi Ali. Are you familiar with Ayaan Hirsi Ali?
Yes.
Okay. So, I mean, imagine the type of abuse. I mean, right? Ayaan Hirsi Ali has had to walk around with a full security detail for, you know, certainly well over a decade, I think, because of her positions. And she certainly seems to conduct herself with a lot less victimology and whine factor than Anita Sarkeesian. Now, I don't mean to imply that. I don't know whether Anita Sarkeesian receives threats and so on. If she is abused in this way, of course, it's reprehensible and it should be taken seriously. But again, look at the difference in terms of making a comparison. I mean, Ayaan Hirsi Ali literally fears for her life because there are all sorts of unbelievably brutish people who want to kill her, and yet you've got Anita whining all day long. Again, to use a word that I love to use when it's appropriate, it's grotesque.
She was part of a national news story about her where she had security people walking around with her.
Anita did or Ayaan?
Anita did.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, when you saw her, was there any sort of...
No,
security? Yeah.
No.
That's why I think it's bogus to a degree, because... You know, you saw her, and it wasn't like she was flanked by security at all times. It was just when she was going to this one event where there...
I think it'd be pretty expensive to have security everywhere you go.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I find it stretches credulity to think that Anita Sarkeesian has to walk around with a security detail wherever she goes. I simply can't believe that. I mean, maybe it's true. I don't know.
No, it's definitely not, because she didn't have one when Ben Saar.
Yeah.
And also, I mean, the thing is that I believe that, yes, there probably have been threats issued to Anita Sarkeesian.
Sure, absolutely.
Obviously. Certainly seen some hostile stuff out there towards her. I've had threats issued towards me.
Yes.
Plenty of times. From Muslims who are upset about me criticizing Islam, from Christians who are upset about me criticizing Christianity, even from Buddhists.
Well, you did do a video where you burned the Bible and the Quran.
Yes.
Both.
Ooh. I burned... I burned the Bible, I burned the Quran, and I burned the God Delusion by Richard Dawkins.
And of course, only the new atheists were the ones who you were truly afraid of, because as we now know, because some of these apologists have explained to us, the real sort of global mayhem around the world stems from guys like Richard Dawkins and Sam Harris. These are guys that are, you know, they terrify me. I mean, that's the type of guys that we ran away from in Lebanon, right? You yes. might think that it wasn't, it was maybe guys that were of one particular faith, but in reality, we were trying to avoid professorial guys in tweed jackets who spewed a lot of reason. Those are the guys who were going to behead us.
I know, it's pretty scary. Every time I see Dawkins, I literally shit my pants with fear.
Yeah. You think of ISIS times 1,000, right?
Yeah, I mean, yes. It's worse than ISIS, way worse. Because, you know, yes. ISIS, at least they believe in something, you know?
That's true.
At least they believe in something and they yes. have a moral compass, unlike yeah, these atheists.
No objective morality. Exactly.
They just attack you at any time.
Think of it this way. I mean, if you don't have a Bronze Age moral code to guide you through life, I mean, what stops you right now from going out looking for kittens, raping them, and then decapitating them? I mean, the only thing that stops me from doing that is by adhering to the codes of the Old Testament.
Yeah, we're atheists, so we just try to kill each other all the time.
Yeah.
You know, just for fun. So yeah. We never have our back turned to each other.
I've made several attempts on Ben's life. I'm like, this is just going to be the TJ show soon.
Yep.
But anyway, let's listen to more of what Anita has to say here.
Mention it's not just what is legal and illegal, right? Harassment is threats of violence, but it's also the day-to-day grind of you're a liar, you suck, you know, making all...
Okay, no, sorry.
That's criticism.
Yeah, that yes. that is just criticizing you. You are a liar. You've been demonstrably shown to lie on several occasions.
So let me draw an analogy here. I think it might be apropos. So as you may know, in terms of the peer review process, when an academic submits a paper to a journal, he or she has probably spent several years thinking about the problem, then designing an experiment or some other data collection, collecting the data, writing up the paper. Then they send it to a journal, and then it gets butchered, killed by reviewers, right? I mean, if you send a paper to a top journal, you have anywhere from, you know, 2-5% chance to maybe 10% chance of getting the paper published. So you've just spent 2-4 years working on a project day and night, which has a very, very small chance of being accepted. So have I been raped by the peer review process because I'm constantly criticized for my work?
Yes, you really
most
have.
Certainly.
It's yes. sick the way they do that. You know, I think that, you know, we need an open scientific journal that accepts all points of view of what science is. And, right. you know, especially if they're women or minorities in any way.
Some climate scientists challenge the notion of climate change, TJ. We should listen to their point of view.
Everyone's yes. point of view. Yeah. It should just all be printed.
Can't
well, or, for example, teach a debate, right? You've got evolution, you've got intelligent design. You got to teach both, right? You've got to have the earth is flat, you know, class, and the earth is not flat.
Oh,
you got to have alchemy and chemistry. Yeah.
There's so many crazy creationists on YouTube, and you should see them reacting to the water on Mars thing. You know, we have one guy that we watch, and he claims that this is just a conspiracy.
Right. Well, there's just a few days. Last week, I appeared on... Karen, I don't know how to pronounce her. Like, is it Strahan?
Something do you know what like that. Strahan. Yes. Yeah, we know her.
Yeah. So I appeared. I think it was on her show, and then I believe she watches
this podcast sometimes. So.
Oh, hi, Karen. So I appeared on her show. I think it was on her show where then I had the idiotic idea of actually checking some of the comments, and I think that a guy had written. And then I flagged him, and then I shared his comments on my social portals, where he said, look, I'm from Missouri, and these kinds of bullshit evolutionary scientists, I mean, it pisses me off with their fake science. I mean, show me a single piece of evidence for evolution, and I'll believe it. Oh, Jesus. I mean, you know what? We'd never gotten around to actually finding one piece of evidence in favor. I mean, think about this guy, right? I mean, he felt sufficiently confident in his stupidity to actually believe that you know, including Darwin, there has not been a single shred of evidence for evolution. Now, the reality is that if you took all scientific theories that have ever been espoused, none has remotely as much evidence as evolution does. In other words, the existence of gravity is maybe on more tenuous grounds than evolution, but this guy felt perfect.
I believe you mean intelligent falling.
God, make this phone fall.
I like that one. I'm going to appropriate that term. From now on, it's the Godfather's term, intelligent falling. I like it. Good
job. No longer the theory. Gravity's the theory of gravity. Just remember that.
Very good. Very good. I like it. It does. But by the way, you know that there's a term differently weighted. You do know that, right?
Differently weighted?
Yeah.
What does that mean? Is that for fat people?
Exactly. Well, you know what? I'm very offended that you said that because I have some fat on my stomach and I feel very threatened by your verbal words right now.
Hey, I'm so fat that I probably have bigger tits than Anita Sarkeesian does. So
I will
I'm allowed to say it.
That comment.
It's like, you know, how black people can say certain words.
Right.
Fat people can say it as well, you know. I can call anyone a fat ass or anything I want because I'm fat too. So
well, I was so when I go to see my physician and he says, "Look, your BMI is not good. You need to lose some weight." I tried to push the argument to him that, you know, I feel very attacked by his use of BMI and overweight and bordering on obese. And I thought, look, I'm just differently weighted, doc, to which he looked at me with some suspicion. So I tried to pull the social justice warrior angle, but apparently he didn't budge and I do have to lose weight. There you go.
Yeah. And let me ask you a question. You know, as a fellow fat guy, do you ever get this argument put forth to you that you must not be very intelligent because you're fat?
Huh. And, that sounds, you know, familiar.
If you were truly intelligent, you would know better than to eat the way you do or whatever. What do you make of that sort of thing?
I've never had that attack, to be honest with you. I've never
been I've had it. That. What would you say if someone said that to you?
I'd say I don't know if there is a link that's ever been uncovered between your weight and your intelligence. But incidentally, though, there is a guy who got into a lot of trouble for a tweet that sort of relates to what you just insinuated. There is a colleague of mine, a lovely guy and a very accomplished evolutionary psychologist by the name of Jeffrey Miller, are you at all familiar with his Tweetgate situation? I'm calling it Tweetgate.
No, I am not.
No.
So Jeffrey Miller is a guy who's, you know, published tons. He's written great, you know, best-selling books. Lovely guy, you know, very mild-tempered guy. As often happens when people make these faux pas on social portals, he wrote a tweet that, you know, I think he thought would be just kind of a quip, like a cute, haha, funny, you know, I'm a Woody Allen, you know, witty guy. I'm going to paraphrase the sentiments of that tweet. He basically said, "Hey, overweight doctoral students, if you think if you can't avoid the pasta dish, what makes you think that you could finish your dissertation?" Or something to that effect, right?
So, wow, that is so othering.
I'm triggered.
Well, you cannot believe the outcry that happened as a result of that tweet. So he was a visiting professor at NYU, at Stern Business School at the time. His permanent position is at University of New Mexico. Mm-hmm. And so he didn't get renewed at NYU. And he wasn't fired at University of New Mexico, even though he was tenured. But the range of punishments that he faced were truly straight out of Soviet Union gulag camp in Siberia number 13, right? He had to be censored. I mean, he couldn't be in, you know, with students alone. I mean, I can't remember the details, but think about it, right? I mean, this guy made a idiotic, ill-advised, arguably, you know, obnoxious tweet that, you know, many people might make if they were in a social setting where they just say a stupid joke. And it almost ruined his career. It's baffling.
Doesn't that scare you, you know, when you see someone else in, you know, with a similar job getting in so much trouble just for not towing the SJW progressive line. Don't you worry that, you know, something like that might befall you at some point just because you're out there saying what you're saying?
It's a great question. And I think that if I were in the least bit strategic and in the least bit a careerist, then I think that what you're suggesting would make perfect sense. But either fortunately or unfortunately for me, I'm not made that way. In other words, all the things that have led to my successes in life are precisely those things that maybe could also lead me down that trap, right? I'm irreverent, I'm pathologically honest, I'm a fighter. And so those things that led me, for example, to found the field of evolutionary consumption, going against the paradigm, not caring, and saying, I'm going to prove you all wrong, is precisely the same thing that gets me angry when I see the thought police or the language police trying to restrain our thinking, our words. And so if anything, it only, I double down, right? And the reality is, I say, look, if guys like me don't exist, then we will all be led to the abyss quiet while, you know, singing love songs. And so, yeah, maybe I should be more careful. But the reality is, I think I'm always very measured. I mean, yes, I always tackle very controversial issues, but I never shy away. But and frankly, I mean, if I hope you don't mind me saying, one of the reasons why at one point I was reticent, not knowing if I should come on your show or not, is precisely because I didn't know, you know, what kind of environment we would have and whether that would precisely affect the fact that ultimately I am a professor and there needs to be some decorum,
sure.
Which of course you've completely not violated. You guys have been nothing but gentlemen. But, you know, so yes, I'm aware of the concern that you raise, but frankly, I just don't care. The truth.
Okay. I like that. I like your answer. I really do. Okay. We're going to watch another video. This one is from a YouTuber named Steve Shives, and he's going to make the argument of why atheism needs feminism and why YouTube needs feminism.
Got it.
Atheism and feminism are naturally complementary to one another. There is no human institution that has done so much in so many cultures across such a long period of time to hold women down as organized religion. For most of the history of civilization, the proposition that women ought to be treated equally to men was just as radical as the proposition that gods did not exist. Before I get too far into this, I want to make it clear that I will be using multiple senses of the word atheism throughout this video.
Sorry, what? Multiple senses of the word atheism. I believe there's only one sense of the word atheism. There's really not much of a gradient there. It's one of the few things that actually is just a true on-off binary.
Right.
Okay.
So this will be obvious to most of you from the context of what I'm saying, but bitter experience tells me that it will not be so obvious to a few of you. So before you post an angry comment presuming to inform me that atheism means not believing in gods and that's all it means, let me say that I agree with the first half of that statement, but also remind you that not everyone uses the term to mean that and only that.
Okay, well then they're just using it. They're using it incorrectly then.
So what is he going to say what the other meanings are?
Yeah, I'm hoping he will. Let's see.
Okay. Atheism can also refer to the community of atheists or the body of work produced by that community.
No, it can't.
That makes no sense.
No, that's just gibberish. That's complete nonsense. Would you agree that that's complete nonsense, Godson?
It smells like gibberish. I must admit.
Like S.E. Cupp is an atheist. TJ, do you agree with her?
No, I don't.
I mean, there you go. I mean, there's a vast array of opinions from atheists.
Who is this guy, by the way? To give me some context, who is he?
This guy is named Steve Shives. He is a YouTuber. He's fairly popular. He has about 53,000 subscribers, I believe. And he has sort of an SJW bent. I think that's probably already obvious.
Yes.
And that's pretty much all the backstory you should need.
Okay.
Totally legitimate to notice trends within that community or body of work and to propose that something be done to change those trends that I find troubling. I'm not proposing that we redefine what atheism means, and I'm not suggesting that people who disagree with me about stuff are not authentic atheists.
Okay.
Okay?
Thanks.
Good. Now I'm going to turn into another shot to disguise a jump cut.
Okay, good.
Hey, as I was saying, given the fact that both atheists and advocates for the rights of women have historically been oppressed by organized religion, and also given the fact that modern atheism has largely rejected...
You know, first wave feminism was actually in league with a lot of religious organizations. You know, it was kind of like the white Christian girls club at the time.
Right. So you mean the suffrage movement, those guys. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know,
wasn't that also part of the temperance movement too?
Yeah. They kind of spearheaded the temperance.
Oh, yeah.
So he's basically saying that by ultimately getting rid of religion, that advances the cause of feminism. Did I summarize that accurately? Is that right?
I'm not quite sure yet. Let's take a little bit.
Other regressive attitudes traditionally promoted by religious fundamentalism, like hostility to science and modern medicine, or overt prejudice against LGBT people, you might think that atheism and feminism would be the strongest of allies. And in the minds of many atheists and many feminists, they are. Thanks to the internet, I have a fairly large circle of friends and acquaintances who, like me, identify as both atheist and feminist, and find that the two fit together quite neatly. My friends and I aren't alone. Voices supportive of feminism are everywhere in the atheist community. Unfortunately, there is also a faction within atheism that is aggressively hostile toward women in general and outspoken feminists in particular.
There's your face.
There
TJ.
I am.
Oh, there he is. There he is.
Yeah, there's
my speckled guy, right?
Yep.
You're just hostile towards women in general. Feminism.
You're the guy with the red hair, right?
Oh, yeah. That's me.
Spot on.
Actually, that is my video, though. Feminism versus freedom of speech. And as you see, 5 million views there.
Holy moly. Tell me your secret.
You just gotta be. You know, your main problem right now. If I was looking at your channel, yeah. Well, no, it's not even that. It's just you need more incendiary titles.
Oh,
you know?
Right. Okay.
Your video I was talking about earlier. What was it called? It was called
racial favoritism across racial lines.
Yeah. You should have just called it Black People Can Be Racist Too. It's an oversimplification, but I guarantee you would have got 10 or 15,000 more views.
Got it.
So you gotta act like you're writing headlines. You're in marketing. You should know.
There you go. I'm failing as a marketer.
No.
This faction is most active here on YouTube. Within it are several of the most subscribed to atheist channels. These regularly feature videos attacking feminists, spreading misinformation about feminism, attempting to undermine efforts to address problems of importance to feminists, such as sexual assault and wage.
It's funny to point out that to guys like this, you're a misogynist, but then like to the people that that were tweeting God, you're a
SJW. Yeah.
Right,
some people warned him that this is like an SJW podcast. Right. So I don't see, you know, do you get that impression at all, Professor?
Well, as relating to this guy we're talking about, or you're losing
as just relating, as relating to our show in general, do you feel like we're an SJW show?
Frankly, I'd not really watched you before today, but based on our conversation today, I don't find that there are many things that we are disagreeing on. And so I will grant you the Godfather's imprimatur as a non-SJW show. And
Thank
I expect
you.
In return to see at least an increase to 10,000 subscribers by the end of the show. Otherwise,
everyone go to Godside's channel and subscribe immediately. It is in the description section of this video.
Do it now.
And follow him on Twitter and Facebook and whatever other social media he has as well.
There you go. You're very
That's
kind.
Very, very important to do. Extremely important. Extremely.
I mean, I talked about this, I think, on the Joe Rogan show, that I just think that these new social portals, whether it be YouTube or, you know, anything else, it's such a wonderful, I mean, it's such a gift, right? And I'm amazed that other academics don't jump in, probably because of the reasons that you mentioned earlier, that they're afraid and they're tepid and they're timid and they're worried, they're scared of their shadow.
I heard you say in an interview once, actually, when you were talking about your fellow academics, that you think that cowardice should be added to the seven deadly sins as the eighth deadly sin.
Oh, I think that was maybe on Dave Rubin, if I remember
that
correctly.
It was on the Rubin Report.
Yeah.
That was a great interview.
Thank you. Look, here you are, right? I look at your numbers, 100,000 subscribers, millions of views. You guys would have not had any of these opportunities. And many of the guys that I spoke to, Sargon of Akkad, the David Pakman show, all sorts of guys who, have their unique voice to add to the landscape, could never have had these opportunities, 5 years ago, 10 years ago. And so I'm amazed that more academics don't jump on this bandwagon, because I always say, look, my job as an academic is to ultimately create knowledge, share knowledge, discuss knowledge, whether it be within the more restrained scientific areas that I specialize in, or to discuss broader ideas as we are right here. And to see so many academics, or so few academics, actually take these opportunities, I find it disheartening. And I wish more guys would jump into the mix to be on your show. Why not? It's all about spreading ideas, right?
Encourage them. We'll have them on, totally.
Good.
Let's see if this guy ever comes around to making some sort of point.
Beyond that, their supporters eagerly join the effort, inundating comment sections
sycophantic
with insults,
pedantic
demands for evidence of even mundane and uncontroversial claims, and childish declarations that they have been pwned or wrecked.
Okay.
Commenters of this sort also like to challenge feminists to debates on behalf of their favorite anti-feminists.
It's a waste of time. They never accept.
Occasionally, especially if the target is a woman, they'll even resort to doxing or threats of physical violence.
Okay,
what's doxing?
Doxing is basically when you release
their private information, their address, their phone number,
in the hopes that you can, lead other people to harass them. And of course, that is a scummy thing to do.
Of course.
And so is personal threats of that nature. But calling someone's ideas bad or stupid or wrong, there's nothing wrong with that. That's okay to do. That's part of a discourse.
But isn't it always categorized as like everyone opposing them is doing this?
Yeah, but right. that's the thing they always do is, they'll find a few people who are doing harassment tactics, and they'll try to characterize everyone who's critical of feminism as being in league with those people, when I roundly condemn anyone who would do anything like that.
Right. Now, I'm trying to think of anybody that I know that operates at the nexus of feminism and atheism. And I don't remember her name, but regrettably, I remember the name of the guy that she's associated with, whom I despise, P.Z. Myers, or I think you guys in the U.S. would say P.Z. Myers.
Yeah.
Do you know who that is?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
I've had dealings with
him. There was...
He's a real scumbag.
He loves you, TJ. He loves you.
There was, at one time, a pretty united atheist community on YouTube, and then the feminist YouTubers kind of caused a rift.
But who's the woman? I don't know her name, but there is some woman who recently sort of gained prominence within that movement. Can you help me with the name?
There's Lacey Green, and there's Rebecca Watson.
Well, I think it's the second one.
Rebecca Watson.
Because the only reason they've come on my radar is I wouldn't know who these people are other than some of the sort of lay people who are, vociferous detractors of evolutionary psychology are followers of these two idiots. And apparently they're sort of the new, gurus of anti-evolutionary psychology. So I wanted to find out who is this woman who is so respected for her. And of course, she's not respected among real scientists, but amongst sort of the lay people who hate evolutionary psychology, she's viewed as a person who's kind of given the 1-2 death blow to evolutionary psychology. And it's really laughable. She's a communications major. Not that I wish to argue from authority or from credentials, not at all. But she's an idiot. And yet I often will get people who say, but Rebecca Watson dismantled evolutionary psychology. Oh, geez, guys, let me call all my evolutionary psychology friends. And we need to look for a new job because the jig is up. We're out of a job. Rebecca Watson has told us that we're a bunch of idiots.
Yeah, so I actually I actually did a quite popular video about a scandal that she was involved
in. Oh, the coffee scandal?
The Elevator Gate.
Elevator Gate.
Do you know about Elevator Gate?
Is this where she was at a conference and somebody tried to pick her up or something?
It was in Ireland, and I believe Richard Dawkins was at the same conference also. Right. He ended up commenting on it. Basically, she was out drinking with friends, and one of the people she was out drinking with was alone in an elevator with her and invited her to his room to have coffee. And apparently that was assault.
Yes.
Yes, because she just wanted to go to her room and read her Simone de Beauvoir book, and here this guy was throwing himself at her. Is that the general idea?
Right.
Of course.
You know, she's just like, guys, don't do that. It's really, you know, whatever. But the thing is, actually, that was probably the moment that Richard Dawkins got into his first hot water with the SJWs when he criticized her.
And
he said, you know, what happened to her was no big deal. It's a non-event. You know, I don't even see why anyone is taking
it seriously. Yeah, the guy took the rejection. He's like, okay, that's it. And that was the end of it.
Right. And basically, that was actually the point where Dawkins started drawing the ire of the feminist SJW PZ Myers crowd.
He's a misogynist.
And well, I think I was first exposed to Myers. Or one of the first times I was exposed to him was, are you familiar with the Satoshi Kanazawa? It's another one of those scandals that happened within evolutionary psychology. Are you familiar at all with him, Kanazawa?
Nope, sorry. No.
So he's a evolutionary psychologist at the London School of Economics, so a very prestigious school in England. And, you know, he's published many, many serious papers. He was a very, very popular blogger at Psychology Today. But, you know, he's the type of guy who really pushed the envelope. In part, precisely, as you mentioned earlier, he would pick these very sort of provocative titles, always pushing the envelope. In other words, not being quite as gentle in his language as an academic. And at one point, he had written an article where he was describing some research by somebody else where they had found that apparently people had rated Black women as less attractive than whatever, some norm or some other group of women. And this, of course, was viewed as, you know, astonishingly racist. There was a huge movement to get him kicked out of his tenure job. He was ultimately let go from his Psychology Today blogging duties. And I actually wrote an article, and many people wrote me privately thanking me for having the courage. I wrote an article saying, you know, to purge a blogger sets a very dangerous precedent. I mean, if this guy is a quack, if he's a racist, if he's wrong in his positions, let his words come back to haunt him, right? Let his words stay there and let him suffer the consequences of his idiocy. But you certainly don't purge the guy, right? I mean, people are allowed to be idiots. They're allowed to be racist. And it wasn't clear that he was a racist. But anyways, P.Z. Myers jumped on that bandwagon and basically said, you see, there you go. Look at evolutionary psychology. All evolutionary psychologists are a bunch of quack racists, which, of course, is exactly the cognitive mechanism by which people are racist, right? They attribute to, you know, the behavior of one guy. You know, all Jews are tax cheats, right? So he was doing the exact same thing, right? Because this one evolutionary psychologist had engaged in this behavior, all evolutionary psychologists must be a bunch of quack racists. And that's how I first was exposed to him. So then I tried to engage him once or twice on Twitter, and he basically blocked me. I mean, I wasn't following him, but he blocked me. Now, the only reason I engaged him, because he's certainly not a serious scientist, but when I saw the number of hits he had on his website, or on his blog, like 100 million. I thought, well, this guy's got a huge platform. He's spewing all this hatred against my discipline. Let me try to engage this buffoon. He ran away. And so to go back to your original question, that's why in part, I do what I do, because I'm really committed to the truth in a respectable way, right? In a respectful way. Let's dialogue, let's debate. And that's how you know that these guys are idiots, because when somebody with substance, if I may say about myself, comes to debate you, you block me.
I agree. And, you know, that's kind of what I was talking about earlier, is this group of people does not want to defend their ideas. They just want to, you know, sit in some faux ivory tower of their own design and hurl invectives and shit at people below them.
Yeah, make moral pronouncements. Right.
You know, that's we are the morally just. We are the morally righteous. Everyone else is scum and filth and beneath our contempt, even.
Their commandments and pronouncements. That's how it is. Right. That's it.
Now, do you feel, here I'm genuinely, this is a genuine question. Do you feel that bent is a lot more prevalent among the left than the right? And if yes, why do you think that is? And I'm not sure I know the answer to it, but I'm curious to know what your take on it is.
You know, I would say that it is more prevalent in the left than the right. I would consider myself left wing, by the way. I would consider myself liberal. But yes. I do see that it is these the PC variant of liberals are extremely intolerant of any other point of view to the point where they don't want to engage. They don't want a dialogue. They don't want a discussion. All they want is a pronouncement that they're right and that anyone who disagrees with them must be mansplaining or a rape apologist or whatever sort of aspersion they can cast
at
that person.
And nothing is ever different. There cannot be any differences. If you observe a difference, there's something wrong with you.
Right. Now, do you think that's because in many of the forums where these public exchanges are happening, you're likely to have a preponderance of leftists, and therefore that's why you attribute that bent to them? Whereas if let's suppose most faculty members at universities were Republican rather than Democrats, do you think that you would have the same behaviors, because both groups ultimately are dogmatic and it's whomever is in power that's going to...
I do believe that, yes.
I think
if the situation were reversed, it would be the same. It might even be worse, honestly.
Yeah, it depends on the website. Because, like, some websites you visit, you'll see a definite bias towards, like, liberal ideas, and you'll see some that are kind of in the middle, and you'll see some that are totally just out there.
Yeah, I mean, like, every group is capable of having its own echo chambers, but I think that it does... It seems like it's more prominent in the left wing at this point. Because even, you know, right wing people, even if I feel like sometimes they engage in disinformation, or I think that something they said is dishonest or doesn't factor all the things in. I mean, I know that they're essentially looking at the world from a different worldview, but I've always found that those sorts of people are usually willing to engage with me in discussion.
Yes. And to follow on what you're saying, you know, this is anecdotal evidence just based on personal observations.
Sure.
You know, if I look at my Facebook friends on my personal page, I've got, you know, very leftist folks, you know, many of my academic friends, and then I've got sort of more right folks that oftentimes won't be in academia. And of course, they both hold quite entrenched positions, but there does seem to be a greater proclivity of the folks on the left to engage sort of in totalitarian moralizing. Did you see what I mean? In other words, if you wish to be a member of the progressive card-carrying members club, then you better say that Obama is the second coming of the Messiah. And any position that would suggest otherwise, well, basically, you need to be, repudiated. And I don't quite, as you said, I don't quite see it amongst the right, not right wing, because that sounds fascist, but sort of the right leaning folks. And it's a real shame. And I think that's what Dave Rubin is really trying to change, right? Because true liberals, which of course I count myself amongst those, and probably you guys do too, and Dave Rubin and Sam Harris, are losing the discourse to these regressives. And we need to sort of take it back from them.
Do you think we're going to lose?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I actually literally stay up at night worrying about this, because there are profoundly serious issues that the world is facing. And if, to use a term that I used originally on Rubin Report, if we don't all collectively grow a pair and start doing our part in engaging in the discourse, I think that, yes, there will be a tipping point where we will lose. Now, as somebody who's come out, not to sound too dramatic, but as somebody who escaped the Lebanese Civil War, which was astonishingly brutal. I mean, it's the standard by which subsequent civil wars were, you know, were compared to the Lebanese civil war, I see similar nefarious forces creeping up into the West, where we are tolerating the intrusion of totalitarian religious ideologies because we're too weak, because we're too politically correct, because we're too culturally relativist. And people need to wake up and say, look, in a free society, we won't concede an inch of our freedoms under the guise of tolerating the practices of others. And if we don't do it soon, I think eventually, if not losing, it'll be a lot more costly to win later. So let's nip it in the bud today rather than at some future time period.
I agree. Let's take a look at a little bit more of this guy's video and see if he can generate any more useful discussion for us.
Yeah.
The high-profile anti-feminist YouTubers don't directly instigate these actions of their followers, but they don't seem all that concerned with them either, despite these sorts of things being done in their names by self-professed fans of theirs all the time. There are two major results of this. First, feminists, especially women, either stop participating in the YouTube atheist community or decide not to start. And second, the atheist community as a whole is perceived by those outside of it as being a place where sexism and misogyny are not merely tolerated, but rewarded.
I'm sorry, but you're the one that's propagating that narrative more than anyone else. You're the one
he
who's...
I'm sorry, Greg.
Go ahead. No, you go ahead.
I was going to say he's got a holier than thou, as if he's almost like a Southern Baptist preacher, a cadence or timbre to his voice, right? The way he's delivering it, right?
Yeah, and also I think it's ridiculous that he's sitting there saying, oh, this community is so misogynistic and it's so horrible and it's all these things. And, you know, that scares women away. It's like, you know, don't you think that you're contributing to that by describing it as such? Because anyone who actually goes and watches those videos like that I've made about feminism can see that there's nothing misogynistic about them.
Yeah, you're
whatsoever.
Critical of the ideas, very seldomly the people.
I believe in gender egalitarianism. I believe that women deserve all the same rights and shit that men have, and I believe they should be treated equally, and I believe they are equal in most respects that matter. And, you know,
there's misogynist
differences and shit, but... You know, there's probably ways that women are generally better and ways that men are generally better, whatever you want to define better
Only women can be better. Men can't be better.
You know, I'm not coming at it like, fuck women, I'm a misogynist, and here's why women are all irrational hags that have nothing of value to say.
But that's how they're
interpreting that's how they
you.
Portray it.
That's how they interpret it,
They basically just go look at the title that says, you know, feminism versus freedom of speech, and they say, oh, well, he's casting aspersions at feminism, so obviously he's anti-women.
They don't even look at how the meaning of the word feminism has changed.
Right.
It's been in a perpetual state of change.
Yes. Right. As words do.
Incidentally, in my own work, you know, I've often noted how depending on whether, because you remember earlier, just a second ago, Ben, you said, you know, only women could be found to be superior. If men are found superior on something, then it's sexist. Well, to follow on that point, so I'll describe some finding from evolutionary psychology. Let's say a convergence of findings that demonstrate that women have certainly evolved to seek multiple partners under certain conditions. In other words, there is a adaptive reason why women would engage in sexual variety seeking. Well, to the extent that finding is congruent with whatever the feminist narrative of the particular audience, it's empowering to women that they too are not these prudish, Victorian, dainty creatures. Well, then, you know, the feminist will come up to me and say, oh, brilliant, Dr. Sad, what beautiful research. On the other hand, 2 seconds later, if I give a scientific finding or an evolutionary principle, on average, men score higher on sexual variety seeking than women. Oh my goodness, what a Nazi Dr. Mengele sexist pig, right? So the way that the scientific findings are evaluated is not using some established, you know, scientifically valid set of criteria. It's rather, does it adhere with my pet ideology or not? If it adheres, it's good science. If it doesn't adhere, you're a Nazi.
And they're just revealing their bias.
So basically just confirmation bias on a grand
scale.
Exactly.
Now, to the extent that a lot of the findings in evolutionary psychology and their warped views are detrimental to their narrative, then they hate evolutionary psychology. But again, if they understood evolutionary psychology, they'd actually find that many of the most fundamental principles of evolutionary theory are, quote, empowering to the feminist narrative. So, for example, let's take the most basic example. Sexual selection is the process that explains, the evolutionary process that explains, you know, how behaviors or traits evolve that confer reproductive advantage, right? So, for example, the peacock's tail evolves not because of survival. If anything, it reduces the survival likelihood of a peacock, but it's because it is meant to attract females. It serves as an honest signal of his qualities, right? Now, sexual selection in almost all species, not all, but in most, is completely driven by female mate choice. In other words, the whole fundamental building block of a key evolutionary process known as sexual selection is completely in the hands of females across species, including humans. So when you put it that way, you actually realize that females have an incredibly important influence on the evolutionary trajectory of species in general and of humans in particular. So once I couch it in this way, oh boy, it's empowering to the feminist narrative. But on the other hand, if you say, well, men have evolved to prefer to mate with young women rather than octogenarians, my God, what an ageist pig you are. What do you mean? We're taught to not like 80-year-old women. Really? You don't think that if a man were born with a proclivity to mate with 80-year-old women, his preference would have died out with him because he can't pass on that preference? I mean, you don't need to be a fancy evolutionary theorist to understand that. So you see how every single finding is always put through the lens of my ideology. It's disgusting.
Yeah. But, you know,
as a side note, TJ is totally into 80-year-olds.
Yeah, you know.
Well, those preferences, TJ, are going to die with you, son.
Oh, well, I didn't want to procreate anyway. Let's see if we have anything else in the bag of videos that might inspire some conversation.
I've reached my threshold with this guy.
Yeah,
please.
We're done with him. We're done with him. Don't worry. Right. We're gonna take a look at someone that's probably just as annoying, though, because that is kind of what we
enjoy.
Let's take a look.
Welcome to Feminist Fridays, a series where we explore the social, the political, and the media from a feminist and intersectional perspective, and use a lot of F words. Today, we're going to talk about privilege and what privilege means. In our culture, we're taught to see things like gender, sexuality, race, and class as something that puts people at a disadvantage. AKA, people of color are more disadvantaged than white people on the basis of their skin color, or poor people are more disadvantaged than rich people. But in doing this, we often fail to recognize the areas in which we're privileged. As a predominantly straight, cisgender person who comes from a middle-class family and is able to attend college, I have privilege because of my sexual orientation, because my gender identity and expression matches my biological sex, and because of my class and my access to education.
Yeah.
She can breathe. She has breathing privilege.
I mean, honestly, it was difficult to keep my lunch, my dinner, without regurgitating it. This whole thing where you begin, and you see it often in postmodernist writings, where you begin by sort of confessing all the descriptors of your identity, right? I'm a Middle Eastern cis male, differently weighted, whatever, give me some other descriptors, olive-skinned, Jew, atheist. I mean, why do you have to, I mean, why can't the merits of your argument, whatever idiotic argument in this case she might be making, why can't that be made without, you know, first introducing all of your descriptors?
Well, because identity politics, you know how
exactly
it goes.
Right, exactly right.
You know, it's like I have to preface everything by letting you know.
I am one of you.
You know, I am a white bisexual male, and this is now what I think.
She said she used a word, did she say predominantly? She qualified her sexual orientation with a qualifier. I think it was like predominantly heterosexual or something like that,
yes.
Right?
So she's so, predominantly heterosexual.
So in that sense, she's exhibiting the luminary bent of having Here, you're going to like this one. Sexual fluidity, right? She's not constrained by this whole binary view of sex. You know, I'm right. either attracted to men or women, right? She, as somebody who is more enlightened, she can sort of navigate through the fluidity. And that's what I try to seek. I mean, one day I'm attracted to my beautiful wife, but on another day, because I'm also enlightened, I could be attracted to hairy Turkish guys. It just really depends
or
on my
situation. You never know. You know, it could be anything.
Yeah, it could be anything.
A vending machine.
Actually, you
know
what?
Who
I'm looking at my Belgian Shepherd over there, and my goodness, she's looking quite attractive.
Oh, you're going to lose your tenure and shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's do this.
Yeah.
I'm also able-bodied and relatively thin, so I don't have to deal with ableism or body shaming. However, yeah. I don't benefit from white privilege because even though I'm half white, when people look at me, they generally don't see me as a white person because I'm mixed race and exotic. And as a woman, I also don't benefit from male privilege. If I were to send a resume to a potential employer, they would automatically categorize me as a woman because of my first name, and then they'd look at my last name and be like, hey, this chick is Asian. So before they even meet me, they're already making assumptions about me based on my race and my gender. In my experience, it seems...
Couldn't... What?
The same can be done to anyone.
Yeah, and also, I mean, like, couldn't you just dispel that when they actually meet you and stuff? I mean...
Here's an interesting question for you. Do you think that this woman in 10 years, 15 years, 20 years will look back at this video and either openly and honestly or in the private recesses of, you know, her bedroom when she's going to bed, say, my God, was I a buffoon when I made that video? Or do you think she will consistently forevermore be the idiot that is depicted here? What's your fear?
My feeling is that she'll look back on it and say, that's when I was too lenient right. on men. That's when I didn't go far enough.
You know, my intuition, and of course it's an open empirical question, my intuition is that this is, you know, when they say, I think the expression is youth is wasted on the young. Is that how the expression goes?
Yeah.
I think a lot of this social justice warrior nonsense is really a manifestation of youthful idiocy. I don't get the feeling that there are too many YouTubers who are 55 who are engaging in this kind of discourse. The exact reason as to...
Wow, more ageism. You're disgusting.
That's true. That was so ageist. There goes tenure. I'm done.
Yeah. It's a... Let's
like
hear more.
People accept the idea of class privilege the easiest because it's the only form of oppression that's still easily measurable today.
It is easily measurable. You don't even need a measurement. Obviously, poor people are not as well off as rich people. That's almost the definition of well off.
That's self-evident.
You know, I mean, whatever.
You know, there you again, I'm sorry, man. I was going to say, you know, again, not to bring back my personal history, but it's very relevant. You really can't imagine how galling it is for people who've had personal histories of true trials and tribulations, right, coming from conflict regions, as I have and as many others have, to hear this stuff, you talk about being offended. I'm offended that this person can engage in this kind of stupidity, right? Because it's manufactured victimhood, right? I mean, think about now all the people escaping Syria and so on, right? I mean, think about these people, what they're going through, and then look at this idiot, the stuff that she's spewing. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, I agree. And, you know, I don't know if you know, but I actually am bisexual.
Is that you're being literal now? Or you're joking?
No, I am. He's not joking. I literally am. But, okay. You know, to hear this shit, like, I'm supposed to sit here and be like, oh, you know, I'm a bisexual, so, you know, I have this oppression going on and happening to me. It's like I'm being denied some privilege of being straight. There's no fucking privileges, all right? Yeah. You know, you make your own way through this world. You decide your own fate, you know, to whatever extent you can. Obviously, there's always going to be factors out of your control. There might be judgmental assholes that are going to judge you for one aspect of your personality or another. You got to overcome that. What? Right. Why can't she? I don't see. It's just like they want to blame society and the world and everyone else for every single problem they have. And, you know, they just want to grossly oversimplify this constant us versus them mentality, you know, and you're either on our side or you're you know, the enemy, and you're a bigot of the worst kind. And it's just right. It's just hideous to me.
It could be a binary choice then.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, go ahead.
I was going to say, you know, I wouldn't know the literature if it already existed, but I wonder if there has been any, you know, serious scientific study of personality traits that are predictive of SJW membership, right? And if it hasn't been done, I mean, I think we could propose some rapid hypotheses. So is there a set of personality traits that are predictive of whether you're going to be an SJW or not? And if it hasn't been done, I think that would make for a great study, because my feeling is there are definitely a cluster of traits that can very well predict whether you belong to this kind of idiocy or not. Do you agree with that?
Yes. Yeah, I do. And tell us some of the traits that you think are universal to the SJW.
So my thinking is, what got me going on this is there's a trait which I think I mentioned in a completely different context on the Joe Rogan show. We were talking about gambling and so on and belief in astrology and all that. So there's a trait called internal versus external locus of control. And so people who are internal locus of control orientation, those are people who believe that things that happen to them because of their own internal machinations, internal dispositions, right? So I did well on the exam because I'm smart, because I studied hard. I did poorly on the exam because I didn't study hard, because I'm an idiot. On the other hand, people who are externally, who score externally on locus of control, typically attribute events in their lives to external factors. Now, on average, people tend to do the following. They attribute successes internally, and they attribute failures externally, right? So I did well on the exam because I'm smart. I did poorly on the exam because the professor is an idiot, right? But coming to the SJWs, my feeling is that people who are SJWs probably score high on external locus of control. And if anybody is watching this and is going to go ahead and do the study, I better get props, because you first heard it from the Godfather. So I think that if you're internally driven, right, if you think that, you know, if you succeed in life, if you succeed in the labor market, it's a function of your internal dispositions, then you don't, it's less likely that the victimology narrative is going to resonate with you, right? Because you believe that ultimately I have to get up every day, take responsibility for my actions, and whether I succeed or not is largely driven to my own behaviors. On the other hand, if you're external, then the SJW mindset is a blessing, right? It allows me to attribute all my stupidity and Che Guevara t-shirt wearing BS to all sorts of external forces. It's due to heterosexism. It's due to, you name it, differently weighted. It's due to fatism. It's due to this. It's due to that. So I bet you just that trait alone would be a huge predictor of membership in the SJW club. What do you think? You buy it?
I buy it.
Oh, yeah.
I also think there's something going on, you know, and this kind of ties into the whole identity politics thing, where I think it's almost like an overcompensation for not really feeling that they have a very established identity.
Right.
So they have to latch on to all this special snowflake shit. And, you know, that's where you get people like, what are called transtenders. Basically, transtenders, not transgender, but transtender, as in someone who's basically not actually transgender, but decides to identify that way solely to get attention, or people who claim to have mental illnesses that they don't actually have, so that there's some unique characteristic about them.
I've got a psychiatric disorder that I wrote a paper in a medical journal that speaks to that. Can I tell you about it?
Sure. Yes of course.
Are you familiar with Munchausen syndrome?
Yes.
And then there is a more specific, more different disorder called Munchausen disorder by proxy.
Yes.
So Munchausen disorder is exactly what sort of you were alluding to, which is I feign sickness, for example. So, and I go to the hospital and I get all sorts of, you know, battery of medical tests because I love the the empathy and attention that I get. So, for example, I might inject myself with an insulin shot so that I can get a reaction, and hopefully, you know, all sorts of people will be fussing over me. So that would be Munchausen syndrome. Munchausen syndrome by proxy is where you use a third party to engage in this behavior. So typically it would be your own biological child.
So yes, usually it's the children, yeah.
Exactly. So sometimes you have it with pets, sometimes you have it with the elderly, but obviously it has to be somebody who's under your control. So whether it be the elderly, the pets, or the children. And so in my case, I was interested in studying or at least theorizing about this phenomenon, because it turns out that the overwhelming perpetrators of Munchausen syndrome by proxy are women, and they do it on their biological children, which from a, you know, evolutionary perspective is quite problematic, because no relationship is more sacrosanct than that between the mother and her offspring. And so anyway, so I wanted to talk about that because there is an exact disorder that speaks to exactly what you're saying.
Right. And you know, the interesting thing is that they seem to exhibit a lot of those. They want the sympathy of, I'm the victim, so sympathize with me and pay attention to me. So it seems like it's kind of almost related in a way, maybe not to the same severe extent. But yeah, I've known a lot of people who were sufferers of Munchausen's by proxy. So, basically the children that were raised in those environments where they have mothers that are constantly convincing them that they're sick and trying to make them sick, even in some cases.
It's horrifying.
Right, it is. And, you know, actually, Eminem, the reason he has such a strained relationship with his mother is because he was she was the Munchausen's by proxy.
No kidding. I didn't know that.
Yep.
Wow.
Marilyn Manson also, and some other people I've known in my personal life. But, yeah, I mean, I think that's a factor as well. I would say that need to be a victim so that you get sympathy for yourself.
Right.
I think it's a big part, is a big component as well to the SJW mindset.
Now, do you think, and that itself would be an interesting question and much easier to answer, do you think that the density of the two sexes, in other words, how many SJWs are male versus female, do you think it's roughly equal, or do you get the sense that there is a greater participation of one sex more than the other? And I have my own intuition, but you tell me yours.
My intuition is that it's primarily female driven, but that the men who are involved are mostly there because they're interested in having sex with the women involved, ironically enough.
I agree with you.
White knighting?
Yes, I think so. That is, I think that's the general interpretation of people on the internet, honestly. I don't think I'm very unique in stating that position.
Or a term that I recently discussed on Karen's show last Friday. Are you familiar with the, it's going to be a swear word, but it's an actual term, the sneaky fucker theory. Do you know what that is?
No.
So that term, I'm not sure who first proposed it, but it's a serious idea. It basically stems from, and we'll apply it in a second to your male SJWs. So it's a term that refers to males within species. So there could be, for example, two types of males or two types of phenotypes, in other words, body types of males within a species, one of which is a clearly masculine male. And then there is a second type of male that actually looks a lot like a female. And the reason why it's called sneaky fucker is because, so for example, if you look at in the context of one particular species that has that, so I can't remember the name of the fish species, the male is very dominant. He sort of is looking out to make sure that no male sort of broach his territory and gains sexual access to his female fish. And then these male fish that look like females will sort of get by his defensive radar to then go in and sneakily mate with the females. And so I think that what you said about the male SJW, how is that for a title of an academic paper? Male SJWs as sneaky fuckers.
I like it.
Sounds wonderful.
I mean, that
makes me admire them more, though, because, you know,
they're duplicitous.
But yeah.
But then if they have sex with the female SJWs, because they were duplicitous, that would be rape. So the male SJW will then be accused of rape, and there goes the infinite loop of victimology.
Well, you know, they need to keep the victim engine going.
We actually used to play some videos from a male SJW that just said, he claimed we should just believe all alleged rape victims right off the bat going into it.
Yeah,
that's
belief.
The default value, and then you have to prove otherwise.
Right.
Yeah. Guilty until proven innocent, basically.
The Napoleonic code. Nice.
Yeah.
Good.
Very nice. You know, I even when I did my videos about the Rolling Stone rape hoax.
What's this? Tell me a bit about it.
Well, it was this girl gave this story to Rolling Stone about how was gang raped at
Duke?
A fraternity.
Was it Duke University?
Or Virginia, maybe?
No, it was
UVA.
Yeah, it was UVA.
UVA?
The UVA rape hoax, basically. Okay. Yeah, and she claimed that she was raped by all these guys as part of an initiation ritual, and the Rolling Stone just printed it as though it were the gospel truth of the world, and of course, a million holes were poked in the story. It turned out the story was probably a complete fabrication. You know, but they ran with it, and I made videos, of course, condemning Rolling Stone for their total lack of journalistic integrity, not doing any proper research on the story before they printed it, and of course, the woman who wrote it was eventually fired, and I think she was actually presented. She was given an award for the worst piece of journalism of 2015 or whatever year it was published.
Right.
But you know, after I did those videos, not even after I did those videos, but in the context of researching those videos, I found tons of people who said, you know, even though this case was a fake, it's still good to always believe the victim and default on their side. And, you know, cases like this are horrible because they're going to make women be treated less seriously when actually, you know, I mean, like, they just want to eliminate due process of law when it comes to rape cases is what it basically boils down to.
The innocent guys have to, in this case, pay the price for a greater cause, right? Which typically you hear the opposite argument, right? You hear the argument that the reason why the justice system is so, you know, fastidious about, you know, about the processes is because you want to make sure, for example, in the case of death penalties, that you never execute an innocent person. They're working from the opposite premise in the example that you gave, right?
Yes.
If a few innocent people have to be wrongly accused for a greater cause, so be it. Who cares?
Yeah, I care.
Right.
Let's take a look at maybe one more video.
Sure.
Did you want to play that Harris one?
Sure. Yeah, we have here someone criticizing Sam Harris. I don't know. How well do you know Sam Harris? I saw you tweeted to him earlier.
Oh yeah. I mean, we've never met face to face, but we've communicated many times. We know each other, you know, quite well.
That's good.
We're talking about the possibility of, you know, doing some sort of podcast together. So yeah, I know him.
That would be great. That would be great. I'd love to see you two guys talking.
Thank you.
This is a video of someone on the left basically coming down hard on Sam Harris. It's a little bit older, but I thought you might still have something interesting to say about it.
Sure.
That's basically my perspective on it. I will say this. I'm out to Sam Harris. And if he wants to come on the show, I'll happily talk to him. But I remain confused as to what... I mean, I think his perspective is clear. Sam Harris's perspective is clear. All of that stuff is secondary. History is secondary. Resource politics is secondary. Arms deals are secondary. Political instability, secretary.
Secretary.
Clearly a misogynist.
Oh, yeah.
Who is this guy?
This is not Sam Cedar.
But this is his show.
This is his show. This is some guest host. I don't actually know this guy's name. I'm sorry. But we'll you know, we can add it to the description of the video later if it really matters to anybody. Let's take a look at what he has to say because it's pretty strange.
Sectarian, you know, issues are maybe less secondary because he can kind of pigeonhole them in some type of reading he has of Islam. But all of the historical, geographic, regional, foreign policy, social, and economic and technological forces that are driving these crises are all totally secondary to selected lines from a Pew poll and out of context Quran quotes. Those are the issues. That's what drives these problems. Not only is that what drives these problems, but these are the biggest threats in the world today. And again, while I would totally accept that religious extremism and terrorism are major issues in today's world, in my view, they don't crowd out global warming, they don't crowd out global inequality, and of course, all of these issues are interdependent. But in Sam Harris's view, actual textual reading of religious text is the paramount thing. The biggest issue is in Islam, and pupil, hadith, line from Muhammad, the Muslims are scary, that's it. Nothing else. That's his worldview. I don't buy it.
So what do you think?
Oh, Lord. I mean, there were so many things to discuss there. I mean, to make the comparison of, let's not worry about Islamic extremism when we've got global warming. I mean, both could be important issues that we have to address. So you don't have to sort of play a competitive game of what's a bigger issue. So let's get that one out of the way. There is an incredible desire amongst many people on the left, as I think Sam has mentioned, as I think Dave Rubin tries to address, as I certainly have tried to address many times, there's a profound blindness or reticence to tackle any issue dealing with Islam amongst the left or some of these regressive lefts for all sorts of reasons. And so what this guy is basically doing is exactly that, right? So whenever somebody starts spewing or enunciating a list of factors, there are geopolitical, there are oxygen reasons, there's carbon reasons, there's alienation, there is formation of the clouds, there's all sorts of reasons, there's tree formation, right? So every possible reason under the sun is possibly linked to this extremism, but it certainly could not have anything to do with the fact that these guys will quote you the exact quotes that are driving them to do what they're doing. So let me draw an analogy. If I were to say, I wear my tefillin every morning, this is a Jewish ritual, because of my Jewish faith. I don't eat pork because of my Jewish faith. I keep the Sabbath because of my Jewish faith. I want to look for the Alamakites, or I can't remember their name, because the Old Testament says that we should get rid of them. All of these things I do because of my Jewish faith. Now, if somebody came along and said, so what is the reason why you do these things or don't do these things? Would I say it's due to alienation, political instability? I mean, surely religion has to have something to do. It's not the only factor. Nobody's saying that geopolitical issues don't matter. But the problem with the left is that they're simply unwilling to grant any credence to the religious motives. So it's nonsense, right? I mean, obviously it's a multifactorial problem, one of which, an important one, is the adherence to the religious texts by these folks. Now, that doesn't mean that every Muslim adheres to all of these texts, but it certainly does mean that those texts exist. And guys like Majid Nawaz is trying to find creative ways by which we can reinterpret those texts. But the idea that we should just bypass, give a free pass to religiosity when it comes to this particular religion is suicidal, right? When an anti-abortionist says, and not that I'm drawing an equivalence between anti-abortionists, I think that there have been 8 deaths in the past 40 years, if I'm not mistaken, so I'm not drawing any equivalences. But if an anti-abortionist says, look, I'm going to kill a physician right now because, and then he quotes a particular passage from his religious text, his Christian text, what would we say the reason is? Would we say it's because of British imperialism? Would we say it's because of the housing crisis of 2007, 2008? That's exactly what Russell Brand did, by the way. He did a video, which I responded to with my own video, where he enumerated a range of reasons why people join ISIS, not one of which was related to their adherence to the religion. I mean, is that possible? I mean, could it really be the case that you could propose a predictive model of why people join ISIS and not mention religion as one of the reasons? We're not saying it's the only reason. but it's not even one of the reasons. So the narrative is broken, right? It's partly because of cowardice. It's partly because of moral relativism. But guys like Sam Harris and Richard Dawkins and Majid Nawaz and Ayaan Hirsi Ali and all these guys, you know, they're not these crazy, lunatic, extremist right-wingers. They're people who actually truly believe in liberal values. They recognize that some religious ideas are contrary to those values, and they speak out against it. And an idiot like this guy, I'd like to bring him to my neck of the woods in the Middle East and see how he fares. He's a buffoon. How's that for an answer?
I like it.
Remember when I think Sam Harris was on this episode of Bill Maher when they discussed Islam, and they just and Ben Affleck was like, "Oh, you guys are just racist."
That's what he's actually. That's what this guy's talking about. Is that?
Oh, okay. That's what he's talking about.
That appearance in the firestorm it ignited, basically.
Well, exactly. And
he's
here's
jumping
what they,
into that fray.
Here's what they do. For example, like, look, if I told you right now, how could we know if Judaism condones or condemns or forbids the eating of pork, right? You would say, well, if you were smart, if you had a brain, you'd say, well, I would look to the religious texts to see whether Judaism forbids or not the eating of pork. What you wouldn't do is say, well, my friend Mordechai Silberstein is Jewish and he eats pork, therefore Judaism allows pork. That's what often happens with discussions of Islam, right? Most people are decent people, right? Most people are tolerant. Most people are fair. So they don't want to believe that there could be elements of a religion that might have some problematic passages. And so what they do is they then turn to their personal experiences and say, look, but I've got a friend, Muhammad Ahmad, who is a lovely guy. He's secular. He's a student. He drinks, alcohol. He eats pork. He believes in gay rights. That's the real Muslim. On the other hand, Yusuf al-Qaradawi, do you know who that is? Do you have an idea? Yusuf al-Qaradawi is one of the leading Sunni theologians alive today. He is the spiritual leader of the Muslim Brotherhood. He has, of course, a PhD in Islamic studies. He's got the perfect pedigree of, you know, a profoundly sophisticated Islamic theologian. Al-Bakr al-Baghdadi, the so-called caliph of ISIS, has a PhD in Islamic studies, right? Whenever I challenge people and say, but look here, look what they say from their religion, you know what their answer is? But they're not true Muslims, right? So their friend Ahmad, who goes to University of Virginia, who's a swell guy, a peaceful guy, that's the true Muslim. But Yusuf al-Qaradawi, the Sunni leader of the Muslim Brotherhood, is a fake Muslim, right? So when you have such a broken narrative where we can't have a honest, open discussion about the matter, that's what I mean when I said earlier that if we don't nip this in the bud, we're going to lose this battle. Look, most Muslims are lovely people, just like anybody else, right? Nobody is contesting the fact that most people are lovely and peaceful, whether they're Jewish or Muslim or Christian or atheist. The question is, are there particular ideas in religious texts that are antithetical to Western liberal values? And that discussion, we could have it without having the fear of being called a bigot hanging over us. If we're truly honest, we should be able to have in a secular society that discussion without constantly having to duck and weave these types of
when it comes to criticizing Islam, I think there's a more profound fear that some people have as well, that they will actually be victimized by Islam, not in the way that Anita Sarkeesian is victimized,
exactly,
but in a more in an actually substantive way. You know, I mean, I just made a video yesterday, 10 crazy Quran quotes. And, you know, a bunch of the people in the comments section were like, oh, RIP TJ, TJ is going to die now, you know, because there is that atmosphere of like, you know, someone might actually do something about this.
But you know what usually the apologists will say to if you quote those things? Can you think of some? Do you have any idea?
Can I think of some of the verses, or can I think of some of what the apologists say?
No. Can you think of some of the rebuttals to you providing those quotes?
Tons of them. You know, it's a bad translation. Exactly. You don't understand the context. You don't understand. You got to look at the book as a whole. You got to look at it in the historical context of the times it was written. Right. You don't understand what the verse actually meant. There's a litany.
You need the Aslan Uyghur Decoder 5000. Are you familiar with that or not?
No, I haven't heard of that.
Oh, come on, man. Where have you been hiding? I did a YouTube clip, which I encourage everybody to go see it, where I introduced the Aslan Uyghur Decoder 5000. Basically, what you do is you input whatever set of words that you want, and it gives you the correct translation. So, for example, kill, 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 rest, and kill, when properly translated through the Aslan Uyghur Decoder 5000, basically says kill with love, tolerance, and kindness. So you see, you racist bigot, you misunderstood what kill, kill, kill meant. There you go.
Oh, I'm so sorry. We're about to end the show, but there was one more topic we wanted to venture on. A friend of the show, and actually he co-hosts the show with
on
us on
Fridays. Yeah,
tweeted something. He's a big anti-advertising guy. He really hates advertising.
Yes.
So he tweeted something. I'm going to let Ben read it because he had it up on his phone a moment ago.
Boy, that's a big switch from Islamic text to advertising. What a segue.
Yeah. So, well, you know, we're the show's about to wrap up, and we just got wind of him saying
we want to end on a high note.
Yeah.
It says, I hope the drunken peasants ask Dr. Saad about the psychological manipulation inherent in advertising.
Yes. So do you want me to sort of give a general answer to that?
Sure.
Yeah, because that's all we got. So
yes. That's sort of part of the conspiratorial mindset that basically says that, you know, all advertising is ultimately part of sort of a nefarious plot to manipulate minds. Now, of course, advertisers are trying to persuade you to do things, but there's also a very, you know, non-sinister element to advertising, right? In a free economy, the provision of information is central to having educated consumers, right? I mean, so to the extent that you, for example, if you want to maximize your utility in terms of which car you should purchase, well, one of the sources of information that you could use is advertising. And so the idea that advertisers are sort of these Nazi plotters, again, it's sort of these guys are creating an archetype that is simply not true. Now, that doesn't mean that advertisers are not in the business of oftentimes getting you to do things that are quite deleterious to your pursuits. For example, cigarette companies have to find a way to convince children to start smoking early, because if by the age of 19 they haven't started smoking, then you're almost likely to never smoke. And so they know this very well. And so they have to find incredibly duplicitous ways to get to children, despite the fact that it is illegal to do so. So of course there is, in some cases, a sinister intent. But to argue that advertising is, it's like basically like saying when feminists say, you know, all the evils are due to the patriarchy, right? So replace patriarchy by advertising and you have the same idiotic conspiratorial bent. Does that give you a good answer?
Yeah, I think so. But what about the commercials that, you know, it's like, you know, some guys are sitting around and they're bored and then they open a Budweiser and, you know, then there's hot women everywhere.
And it's suddenly a party.
Yeah, you know, there's like this big, you know, suddenly it's this big party and everyone's, you know, and it doesn't really do that.
It just appears out of nowhere.
I remember one time I sat down and I wrote down what the message of each ad was, if you take it literally. And, you know, it really is kind of ridiculous stuff at the end of the day.
Yes.
You know, there's a lot of claims made that really are not true. Like, I sat down and I wish I had it right here in front of me, because I literally just every commercial I wrote down what's the subtle message, but what's the direct message of the commercial. It'll be stuff like, you know, nothing. There was this Denny's campaign, I think it was, where, you know, they basically said nothing good happens after midnight except for at Denny's, you know, and, yes, and stuff like that. You know, I mean, obviously people know that this is not true when they, yes, view it. So there is that going for it. But I mean, there does seem to be like a need to almost exaggerate and tell tall tales about the product.
Well, sure, because in many cases you have products that ultimately are quite undifferentiated, right? I mean, advertising wouldn't work too well if this is what you had said, right? Hey, buy my product for no other reason than me telling you to do so. But the reality is that it is perfectly undifferentiated from all other products. Good night, and see you soon at our store, right? I mean, that can't work. That can't. I mean,
yeah, they can't be like, oh, sales will triple overnight.
They can't come on and be like, you know, Windex. I guess it does as good a job as anything.
It's all right. You know,
it's okay.
You're
selling a fantasy, right? You're selling a fantasy. I mean, if you said, look, the functional purpose of any car is to get you from point A to B. So why do you need a Tesla that serves as a peacock? Peacocking signal, right? Why don't we just say, hey, all cars have four tires and a steering wheel, and buy our car. I mean, come on. That's really the benchmark that we want for our advertising communiques? That's silly, right?
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so that pretty much concludes the show. Is there anything you want to, like, try to wrap everything up with? I know that's pretty much impossible, but...
Well, I just want to say that... all my fears about appearing on your show were apparently misguided. So thank you for being lovely hosts. I really enjoyed my time. And I look forward to seeing what the response is going to be like. And hopefully maybe I'll come back on one day again if you'll have me.
Sure, absolutely, we will.
Yes.
Great information.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, guys. Cheers.
And everyone, go subscribe to Godsod's YouTube channel. Follow his
videos.
Social media. All of that is available in the description section of this video. And we strongly urge you to
give
me
a thumbs up. Come on.
I checked out some of his videos when I was researching.
Yeah, we really liked his videos.
I enjoyed
great videos.
Them a lot. So,
thank you so much, guys.
Thank you.
And if you guys enjoyed this video, be sure to give it a big fat thumbs up and let Godsod know what you thought of his appearance in the comment section down below. I hope you guys enjoyed it as much as we did. And have a good night.
You're garbage, TJ.
You're garbage.
FanDuel.com/DP.
You were definitely the worst part of the show, TJ.
I know. I'm sorry.
Okay, thank you.
Join our FanDuel League.
Yeah.
FanDuel.